It's the Bennington Show. Poor Vito stumbled through that opening today. I don't even know what the what of Wall Street you were.
The sloth of Wall Street.
Okay.
Insider trading tips today. Mm-hmm. Really? I didn't realize it was a tongue twister.
I saw you, go out of your way to, really try to bring up what's ever happening on Wall Street like it mattered. And then it all, one little thing, and the opening will fall apart. It's the Bennington Show. I'm Ron Bennington.
I'm Gail Bennington.
Exciting, isn't it, Gail?
It is
These
exciting.
These life and times that we live in.
Oh, my God.
24 hours a day. It's always something.
I have a very big day today because we did a four-month pediatrician appointment, and somebody's got advanced motor skills.
Well, look, I knew that coming in. I mean, you're rolling over 4 months. You're playing peekaboo, running the show.
It's crazy. Yes, she's doing very well. But it's funny because immediately I took a sense of pride, like I have anything to do with it.
No.
Yes, she is highly advanced.
I'll tell you this, it's not even DNA. I mean, she doesn't...
I know.
I see her parents. There's not a lot of motor skills there.
We like to watch movies.
Yeah. Motor boating, maybe, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah, big on that. You'll get used to that around here. You see a lot of motorboating, kid.
Well, good for her. Good for the advancement.
She's very advanced.
You got to beat that competition.
You do. I'm really feeling like she's top baby right
good.
Now.
Good. I think the word you're looking for is boss baby.
Yeah. A lot of people have been calling her boss baby. And she's at the top.
I'll tell you, that movie is hilarious and I've never even seen it. But a baby is a boss? Come on. Gold. Gold, boss, Jerry, gold.
Boss Baby actually does sound like one of those fake Seinfeld movies.
Mm-hmm. Like Raquel.
Chunnel.
What was the paper sack?
Sack lunch.
Sack lunch.
Oh, that Seinfeld. Can't get enough of it.
You mean Steinfeld?
Yeah, not that anything's wrong with the yada yada, right?
Failed.
Beedy beep beedy deep beep beep. Well, I'll tell you right now, and the baby's not walking yet at 4 months, but I'd still put those little weights around her ankles just to get the calves going,
Don't skip leg day.
Yeah.
That's good. That's good advice.
Gotta have those fucking legs in this business.
Yeah, work those calves.
I'm telling you though, people are full of parenting advice. Like random people on the street will stop you with parenting advice.
Everyone, what do you normally hear?
In your family. Well, usually it's bad. Most of the time I hear something, if I go and look it up, it's going to be bad stuff. And I'll tell you, one of the worst piece of advice I've ever got about having a baby is someone saying to me, you don't want to spoil her. So, she cries. Don't rush right to her. And I'm thinking, she's a baby. That's kind of weird. That's going to be strange.
Don't let on that you love her.
And I look it up and it's actually detrimental to their mental health. Because a baby has no sense of ego. She's not going to manipulate you yet. At this point, she's crying because she needs you. She wants comfort. She wants food. It is your job to address it quickly.
How about the people who say, let the baby cry itself to sleep at night?
It's a big debate.
It's very common.
That's a real thing?
Yeah. Forever, yep. Even when my kids were little.
Yeah. That's kind of almost the big start of that was the cry it out method or sleep training, they call it, where you just let your kid cry and scream through the night. And they're within 3 nights, your baby will sleep through the night. And it's but those are the most horrible 3 nights of all time.
And we don't know whether the baby just is at that point going, I'm going to turn myself off because I'm all by myself in this world.
100%. There's plenty of people who think that it spikes the cortisol levels in the brain. And then that creates crisis mode in the baby. And then they're going to be fucked up for life pretty much. And then more than anything, it spikes the mom's cortisol level. You have a physical reaction to your baby crying.
Hate. At that point, it's just hate. Has anyone ever put out a bad parenting book? It would be a lot of fun, you know, just to put it together, get it to hit the market.
Well, the reason I think that there's so much like bad parenting advice is because, you know, it changes within a generation that they go, oh, this thing that we used to do is completely fucked up. And always the people who want to tell you is like some old lady on the street who are like, rub whiskey on her gums if she's crying. You're like, no.
It still seems like a good idea to me.
Yeah, really.
Her first food is not going to be whiskey.
And she's crying so much.
I mean, not fucking shit whiskey. Get something nice.
Something top
Get
shelf.
Some Tullamore Dew, a little Irish. Oh. That's part of your job as the mom to filter through the bad.
Yes, I would say to any parent, probably don't listen to most things people tell you.
I'd say that to any human. That's good advice for a human being. Don't listen to people.
Was there ever like advice of saying like, yes, you should spank your kid?
Oh, it's still.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah.
Still. Absolutely. AP the other day said he still hits his kid with a stick despite everything that happened.
Wow.
He goes, I still take the switch to him. And I think it's the best. Yeah, there's a much larger percentage of people in this country who still spank than most people believe. You know, that are living on the East or West Coast, you know, on California, land of the fruits and the nuts. You know what I'm saying? Earl, did you get hit?
Oh, yeah.
And look at you. You're fucking very well behaved.
He is.
You know, I could count it on one hand, the amount of times I got hit, but you know, you don't forget it.
Did you get hit with a branch?
My father had this, he had a homemade leather belt that he never finished. And that's when he hit me with that once, and that was enough for me.
It was what did you do wrong, Earl?
My brother and I were fighting. Yeah. My father loathes when the kids would fight each other.
And yeah, nobody likes that.
Well, you know, I think that it's great advice. The best way to stop violence is more violence, so that makes sense.
Beat the shit out of
them. Perfect.
You want to fuck with somebody? You're going to take the unfinished belt.
That's an easy win.
There's no fucking way this belt's ever getting done. I have to hit you kids so many times. Why would he even want a homemade belt?
Is he a trapper?
Did he kill the fucking cow?
He's from the South. He's from that time when he still made things.
No, he isn't. The guy grew up in the 60s. No one fucking made things then. That was the beginning of buying. Hey, Rico Suave.
Que paso? That is my real name, by the way, Mr. Bennington.
Nice to talk to you.
You know, thank you for getting me on the air. The worst parents of them all, these are the absolute worst human beings in today's world, are the parents who send their kids to school that smell like a mixture of Camel Light and Marlboro menthols. Kids who smell like cigarettes. That is the worst parent in the world.
You mean cool kids?
That was me. 100%.
Hey, how do we know the kid hasn't stopped for a smoke on the way in?
Yeah.
Smoking was accessible. Today, that is the worst thing you can do to a kid is have your kid smell like cigarettes.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's advice is to smoke in front of them. I mean, that's past bad parenting advice.
Right.
But me and my friends, when I think back on it, I fucking crack up so much. We would steal cigarettes, and we would pass around that fucking smoke. We would just stand in a circle, yeah, pass it like a joint, and fucking make fun of the weak-ass hit each of us was taking off of it.
I would go to school. This happened in elementary school and high school. People would ask. First, I'd be dressed in Marlboro gear, because my parents would fucking send in the Camel Cash and the Marlboro Miles. So I'd go to school with Marlboro shit on. And teachers would be like, so are you smoking, Christopher? Chris, you smell like smoking. No, just my parents. Not smoking yet. It's very, it hurt a little bit.
Why?
I don't know. They were like pissed. They're like, they were like angry at me for no fucking reason. I wasn't smoking.
You were just a different boy. That's all.
The three people changed.
Oh, what a lonely boy. Oh, what a lonely boy. Then Chrissy grew up and he sucked on a cock and it came in his mouth while he was cupping the balls. You shouldn't even deny that, Chris, because you want to fucking be the kind of person.
I fucked up.
No. That would have been a great advice book from your parents. All right, enough. We don't need that. Stupid.
Already got the point across. I'm a lonely boy.
And, you know, you were sitting at home smoking with your parents and watching porn. Everything about your life was weird.
Counting Marlboro miles with them. Looking through the catalogs, trying to fucking figure out what we're going to get. Oh, no. Mom's going to get a suede jacket. Oh, hopefully, do we have it? I would actually said, do we have enough for the pool table in a one-bedroom apartment? I wanted them to get me the pool table.
Well, you lived above a billiards hall. You were fucking fine. Oh, what a lonely boy. Gail, has anyone ever given you good advice?
Yeah, I mean, I guess there's plenty of good advice out there, like people who have had experience with like natural remedies as opposed to like rushing to, you know, fret about if your kid has the sniffles or if they're teething. Like there's a lot more of that kind of advice out there, which I think is pretty cool. But I think like with everything, it's just such a personal thing that I'm sure that for another person, somebody coming up to a person and saying, oh, you should have a amber, you know, a Baltic amber teething necklace. That's the only way to do it. That person would be like, this is totally obnoxious. That's why you probably shouldn't put your parenting advice out there for anyone. You probably just shouldn't give it.
I always say the same thing. This is the time to expose them to other languages. They can pick up on a lot
easier. People do bring that up a lot.
And then I'll also say, you know, they're going to hate piano lessons, but someday they'll be very happy that they did it.
Now, is that still a thing? Is like the people giving advice that's that, almost that tiger mom stuff? Remember that was like kind of a trend with the Asian mothers?
Yeah, well, the Asian mothers are still rocking it, especially those Korean moms. Oh, God. They love to push their kids.
They need those kids to succeed at all costs.
Yeah. I guess for, you know, for the whole future. I always say this. I go, they get a B. Just take them to the subway station and have them think about it.
I just like, I feel like kids are already pretty hard on themselves.
Not this kid over here. I couldn't have been easier on myself. Jeremy in Canada.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
Yeah, just on the smoking with the bad parenting. I started smoking when I was probably 13, 14. And when my parents found out, they couldn't stop it, so they just let me smoke. And when I was in elementary school, I went for lunch with my dad, and he drove me back to school. And before class, we had a cigarette together in the car. And when I went in, my teacher came up to me and said, us non-smokers can smell smokers.
Oh, shut the fuck up. Just, you know what? Just fucking teach me math. Is that too much?
Do your job.
Don't comment on my off-school fucking fun.
When I was a kid, there was a kid in my elementary school that lived, right, with us. His parents got a divorce, was pretty rare. His mom was also English. And fucking crazy hot, very thin in English, and she used to let us smoke in elementary school there.
Oh, she's a cool mom.
Yeah, she was really cool. Fucking cool.
I could be wrong, but I feel like the Brits were like even more into smoking.
Absolutely, 100%.
Than Americans were.
And that's why they were able to conquer the world.
Yeah, their drinking age was lower than ours, too. I think it still is.
They trust their children. They trust the youth.
Well, they got their double-decker buses. They don't have to worry about anybody driving home. Just climb up on the top of a double-decker bus. You know, good for them. Good for the Brits. If only they had one fucking sport they could be proud of.
Not one.
I love their cricket, and that is a sport with no rules whatsoever.
It goes on for days.
And no fucking scoring. They don't know what they're doing with it.
It's fucking bizarre.
And then they like their, what they call football, which we call there's a viral video that is going crazy that is just hockey guys being interviewed. It's about all the cliches. Now, I personally think that you could put this on any sport, But the hockey players have such great accents. I think it's why it's going so damn viral. It says the hockey players speak one language in cliches. So let's just hit this and jump into it.
You know, they're a good team.
They're a good team. They play hard.
Obviously, they're a good team. They have a lot of good players.
They're a good offensive team.
They got a lot of depth. They got a lot of high-end skill, and they got a great team.
They're a good team over there. They'll make you pay.
They do take penalties that you can make them pay.
You know, stick to our game plan.
We've stuck to our system.
We weren't playing our systems the right way.
Just got
to
play our own game.
It's just a matter of sticking with the game, doing what we know that makes us successful.
Stick with it. Stick to our systems.
When we play our game, we do a lot of good things out there.
Things we do well.
Just keep playing our system. It's good.
Play your game.
Yeah, we started off good there, 7-8 minutes there.
You know, the first 10 minutes of the hockey game.
About 15 minutes there in the third.
We're worried about the first 5 minutes.
The last 40 minutes.
First 20.
We're going to have to play a full 60 minutes.
Playing 60 minutes.
Perfect for the whole 60.
Full 60.
There's still 20 minutes to go.
Keep rolling here for 20 more minutes.
Keep going with what we did the first 40 minutes.
First 5 minutes.
First 5, 10 minutes were really good.
First 20, I thought.
We got to have a good 20.
Same time, it's only 20 minutes.
Yeah, good play by Hoff.
It's nice to have Cooch back.
Yarny's in here.
Nice play by Benny.
Talking with Pex.
Talbs.
Bozy.
Kestones.
Nuge and Testy.
Janko.
Nice play by Holly to get it to Pearls.
Great play by Zook there.
Hazy made a great play.
Good play, I think it was Stoner.
Blackie.
Good game by Talbs.
Yeah, we're just keeping it simple right now.
Yeah, I'm just trying to keep it simple.
We just got to keep it simple.
We'll have to simplify here.
Simplify things a little bit.
Keeping it simple and working hard.
Keep it simple.
We had to keep it simple and just get pucks going forward.
Making simple plays.
I just want to get out there and keep it simple tonight.
Keep playing simple, smart, and you know, just
keep and play simple.
We just got to play a simple game.
Play simple.
Play hard.
That's our plan.
Just keeping it simple.
He's doing a heck of a job creating opportunities.
Create some opportunities.
Create chances.
Capitalize on our chances.
Capitalize on our chances.
Capitalize on our chances.
Creating a lot of chances, getting a couple goals.
Like you said.
Like I said.
Like I said.
Like I said earlier.
So, like I said.
Like I said.
Like I said.
Like I said, you know.
Same thing, like I said. We got to keep skating.
We were skating better and, you know, getting pucks deep.
Putting the puck deep.
Put pucks in deep.
He's chipping pucks. He's getting pucks deep.
Getting a lot of pucks deep.
Get pucks deep.
Just put the puck deep.
Getting pucks out. Getting pucks deep.
Get pucks deep. Wear them down.
Get pucks in.
Pucks in.
Pucks in deep.
Puck deep.
Pucks deep.
Keep getting pucks deep and, you know, deep.
I think we've battled.
Battle back.
Battle back.
Winning battles.
Battles in front of the net.
We're out there, two teams battling.
Stick around and battle.
Battled hard.
With our battles.
Yeah, it was definitely a battle.
We just got to keep it simple, stick to our systems, and don't give any time and space to make plays because obviously they got some firepower over there that can put the puck in the net.
You know, the other side of this is what is there to talk about with hockey? It's just hockey. You know what I mean?
Well, I always think it's rough on those guys, no matter what sport, when they immediately grab them and be like, what do you want to say about this? You're like, well, we're losing. So I think you can see how it's going.
It's the weirdest thing. The league makes you talk. The sports reporters want you to talk. But if you say anything other than a cliche, they will say this guy needs to keep his fucking mouth shut.
He's a problem.
And I mean, I never am. I could watch the greatest game in the world. I don't give a fuck what Tom Brady has to say after it because I know he's not telling the truth. I know Aaron Rodgers isn't telling the truth. You're never going to see Aaron Rodgers going like this. I don't know. It's just so cold up here and there's nothing to do at night. I really like to at least see what it's like to play in Miami. Is that crazy? You know, you're never allowed to say the truth.
Yeah.
Who wouldn't say, you know what? If I could play in L.A., I could probably make a lot more money in endorsements. Who wants to be in Oklahoma City? It's a fucking nightmare here. The last thing open is the basketball game. I got nowhere to go after the show. And what would be awful if we were okay with that?
Nothing would be. I mean, look, the NFL is particularly bad because they'll fine you if you don't talk. Like, I think Marshawn Lynch would just sit there in front of reporters. They'd ask him questions. He wouldn't talk. He'd get off in 5 minutes. They'd fine him like $50,000.
Yeah, I think every league is that way. I don't think any league you can. Baseball, they'll fucking go down into the dugout during the game.
Yeah.
What? What? And what do you get then? A cliche. We've got to get thick on the ball. You know what I mean? We got to keep just grinding it out.
I like nothing comes easy in this league. Well, obviously. You're in a fucking professional sport right now.
But no one even say, you know what? I'm so fucking scared. I don't want to get cut from this team. I'll never make this kind of money again. I feel like I'm going to hang myself. If I'm totally honest. I might kill myself if I get cut.
Do you people hear me? You hear what I'm saying?
I remember Ralph Sampson got kicked out of a game against the Celtics, and they had him in the locker room, and he just goes, man, it was a bullshit call. It was, and everyone killed him on it. for saying what basically what he was feeling.
I don't know. I just think that they hire people to get these guys to talk this way. You know what I mean? It's fucking terrible. Chris in Philly.
Hey, guys. Derek Jeter got his ass kissed by the New York media for years of being classy, doing things the right way. He never said one interesting thing to the media his entire, like, 18 years here.
Well, they didn't like him for his personality. They liked him because he brought rings back to New York City after so many years.
He played well.
Yeah. He was a weird machine. Oh, just like Tom Brady is. Some odd, uninteresting machine.
A healthy machine, too. Like, he didn't get injured very often either.
Nothing. Gail, now you're a fair weather sports fan.
Yes.
Do you care what anybody ever has to say?
Never. And in fact, it bothers me. Like, I feel like they're just bugging them. Like, I always see somebody who's like, you know, just kind of like eyeing, just like ready to get off camera.
Do you find it odd that they have these women are the ones who are asking the questions?
Yeah,
there's never a man on the field asking, how do you feel?
Well, I guess the thing that I find weird about that is it feels like they shoehorned women into the show and then just went like, well, this is the one place we can put them. You know what I mean? It's not... It's like because one person did it, they're like, I guess this is where we allow women in this broadcast.
And there's not one that you would say, there's the good one and there's the bad one.
No, because they all ask the same questions. Yeah. They all, you know, they all get, you know, they're 30 seconds in with their little clip and then it's back to you.
And no one believes for a second that the questions belong to those people. They are told, here's the question we want you to ask.
Yeah, I guess like, that they don't allow the types of women who probably are sports fans to do those jobs.
Well, they just won't let them.
Yeah,
you know, speak what they want to. I mean, there's no way Jimmy Fallon asked anything that isn't run through six fucking people. It's just what they do on TV. And there's no coach going to go like this. I don't know. We're down by 20 at halftime. I'm just probably going to just screw around, play some guys that have never played before. This one got away from us. And there's only about a fucking half a percentage point that we could ever come back. So no sense of getting anyone hurt. Larry in Albany. Larry.
Hey, guys. The most honest sports interview you'll ever hear. Look up Earl Weaver. In the 70s as the manager of the Baltimore Orioles.
Yeah, we've done that on the show before. And then there's people who said that that was an Earl Weaver impression. It wasn't Earl Weaver at all. And God knows, all we need is more people doing Earl Weaver impressions. Hey, Brian, what's up?
Hey, Team Bennington. Hey, you know, D1 teams, they bring in media consultants and teach these kids those cliches. They don't want them to say anything at all. They learn right from the beginning. And my brother was playing baseball. It was always, you know, hey, we just, you know, got to leave it on the field. Hey, so it's ridiculous. You're never going to get a real answer because they've taught from time they get to college until the time they get to the pros. Don't say anything.
Don't say anything at all. Dan in Hamilton.
Yeah, that's why Greg Popovich is the best of those interviews.
Well, the thing is, a lot of those won't, because he'll go away and not even talk about the game and start to talk about racism and Trump. And a lot of that stuff has, unless you catch it, you're not going to see it later, you know? And, you know, you'll just be watching the end of the game. Of course, this is a racist country, but it's always been one. Now, you got a guy like Trump who's just trying to pull the white supremacist vote in, and it's working. Because let's face it, this is a racist country. All right. Thanks. See you guys. We're on our way to Milwaukee now. It is very fucking true that with all the kneeling, right, no one really talks about racism. I mean, this fucking kneeling has done zero for this bucking country. Zero.
Yeah. I mean, it was, I think, unfortunately, it was a movement that didn't, you know, they didn't get the message across because I think it got muddled, it got confused, oh, are they anti-troops? And then that became the conversation about whether you can kneel or do something unpatriotic. And the entire conversation just got completely swallowed up by it.
Well, you know, I mean, the whole thing about free speech is a myth as it is. And, you know, only because you can't say, oh, I don't support the troops at all, quite frankly. What? Excuse me, I didn't finish. The reason why I don't support the troops.
I hate you.
Huh? Isn't it free speech to try to shut down someone else's free speech? I think that's just me speaking freely. I'm not going to buy any product of anyone who's ever near that person. Popovich is the only one. He just could just fucking roll up a dead dog in the fucking flag, throw it out in the middle, and say, here's your country. I hate that Kaepernick. Kaepernick was the one that was trying to bring a caravan into this country.
He led the caravan.
Yeah. He was down there doing whatever he could to the fucking... He was handing rocks to the caravan people.
With Nike logos on them.
Unmasked with the stars of Stan and Ollie, Steve Coogan and John C. Reilly. I think John C. Reilly got a Golden Globe nomination today. Perhaps the highest nomination of all the foreign journalist awards that there are in this country.
You got nominated for Best Actor.
Thank you. I thought he was just nominated for Best Makeup. Thanks for clearing that up for me, Christopher. I appreciate it.
You're welcome. Well, that Unmasked, that's happening next Tuesday, December 11th, 12:30 p.m. here at the SiriusXM Studios. You go to theinterrobang.com for a chance at free tickets to Unmasked with Steve Coogan and John C. Reilly.
Are you guys going to do the thing this year where you start the club where you give shout-outs to people who bought shirts and put up pictures, and then you guys are going to do your shirts?
Oh, yeah.
I always get a big kick out of that.
These aren't the shirts.
These aren't the shirts. These aren't the shits at all. I don't know whether you guys like this or not, but the Four Weddings and a Funeral, they're coming back, that movie, and they're making a short film for Red Shirt Day, and it's called Look How Fat We All Got.
I love that movie, so I do care.
It is a... It is a beloved rom-com.
It's just like a perfect rom-com. It's like exactly what you want. It ticks all the boxes.
I like it when the fat guy dies, and then you found out that he was gay, and his lover gives like the best fucking eulogy.
Oh my God. He reads that poem, and it's just like, it's
He
so
was
good.
My north, my south, my east, my west. I don't know whether you guys watched George Bush do his dad's eulogy.
I didn't.
He cracked at a certain, like right at the end when he was like, he said he was the best dad any son or daughter could ever have. And he cracked through that. And he was doing jokes and stuff leading up to it. But that thing where he did that, and then he said, he's going to be with his dead child and holding his wife's hand. You know, because it was only like 6-7 months after. But, I mean, to be able to pull off a eulogy like that, good job, dude. Because he was never one of the great public speakers.
No.
Yeah.
But I'm telling you, he fucking nailed that line. Everybody was going crazy.
There is a weird thing when somebody gives a really good eulogy that you want to, like, congratulate them after.
I've done it before.
Like, as though they've Yeah, because like sometimes you like you crushed that. Like you want to say you did everything. You wrote something great, but you spoke from the heart. You were connected. You were looking away from the paper. I mean, sometimes I feel like people should really get credit for it.
First of all, I don't know why we debate it. You're honoring a life of a person. Nothing could be more important that day. There's nothing stupider than a priest coming out and going like this. Christopher Stanley had many friends, and he was known as a good radio producer. You know what I mean? Like, they'll give that priest
that just
a couple
sucks.
Of things.
Yes, I like, nothing upsets me more than like a priest who didn't know the person gives a bad eulogy. And I was at a funeral like a couple years ago, and it was for a pretty young guy who passed away. So it was like everyone's emotions were really raw. And the only person to go up and speak was a priest that he never knew. And I'm not even kidding you. He started to do crowd work. Like, he started to go into the audience and be like, so what did he like to do? Did he have hobbies? Who can tell me a hobby he had? Did he like to cook? What did he cook? And I'm like, what the hell is this? This is horrible.
Why didn't everybody just start making stuff up? Well, he loved to go shrimping. That was his thing. He would jump on boxcars and ride across the country singing hobo tunes.
He had a bindle over his shoulder every day.
Racist? Yes, he was. But for odd reasons. Hated the Swedes. The Norwegians. Called them snow suckers.
Hateful, man.
Hateful towards the extreme whites. He woke up screaming at night, saying that he had committed a murder in 1987. Bam, bam, bam. Enjoyed the movie American Pie. Said Stifler's mother was perhaps the most fuckable MILF in the history of this. Does anyone know Stifler's real name? Do any of you guys know?
I couldn't tell you what Stifler's real name
is. I never learned it. I absolutely never learned it.
Just called him Stifler.
Stifler. Vito, not even you know Stifler's real name?
No, I almost said Ashton Kutcher, but that was the guy that was in Dude, Where's My Car with him.
Yes, we all know who Ashton Kutcher is. I still say Fonzie. And Henry Winkler's had a long career.
It just doesn't seem like he's Henry Winkler.
Dude, I did the Unmasked with him. It was difficult not to call him Fonzie.
I still call the dude from Anton Chigurh. I call that actor Anton Chigurh whenever he's in another movie. I think it's Javier, the guy from No Country for Old Men.
Oh, okay.
Javier Bardem.
I didn't know that was even his name, Anton Chigurh. What movie?
That was No Country for Old Men. He was Anton Chigurh. That was the first thing we saw him in.
I didn't even know that he fucking heard his name in that movie.
I think Woody Harrelson says it a couple times. They have to like, correct him because he keeps on calling him Anton Sugar.
I always call Woody Harrelson Woody from Cheers.
It just works.
Do you know how long it took me to not call Lee Shriver Cotton?
Dude, you know that I was watching that last night. I was watching Scream 2, and I can't fucking believe how good he is in that as Cotton. He's amazing. I'd be proud to be called Cotton if I was him. It's weird that they even called him Cotton.
I think it's weird that they brought him back for the second movie, because in the first one, he only shows up like in a news clip.
Yeah, but he's great, man. He's so fucking great. He's not in the first one?
He's only in they show like a news story of the mom's murder, and they show him like being led into like a court or something, but he's not in the first Scream.
Vito, what about you? Who's somebody from the movies? Or even television that you only referred to as a character name?
I feel bad because I don't even like this movie series and I really love the actor, but every time I see Gary Oldman, I keep going, oh, Commissioner Gordon.
And oh, come on. That's like stupid. He's not even my number one Commissioner Gordon. That guy I call Commissioner Gordon is from the 60s. So if you said to me, oh, Commissioner Gordon, I would have thought the one that dealt with Adam West. Gail's doing a little nursing right now.
I don't
look at her.
I won't. I apologize. Also, I think that I called Steve Buscemi Mr. Pink for a long time.
No, I call him Buscemi. Jesse.
me, it was John Cassell. He was always Fredo.
Yeah, that's true. Fredo.
There's a Fredo. Even in the dock, when they would show people on the street the picture, they would go, "Oh, that's Fredo. It's Fredo."
Everybody kind of loved Fredo and felt bad when he got killed, even though he was a piece of shit. It's just that the fact that he was the weak one was so sad. You cried?
I cried because the first time I got a VCR was the early 90s, so I was still a little young, so I cried when they killed Fredo.
I cried when I found out Clemenza died in between the movies.
That is pretty sad.
Paulie. I'll just say Paulie from Rocky.
Yeah, also Big Pussy. I don't know his name. From The Sopranos.
Okay. It's just that I had hit the Paulie thing. I thought we were there.
Paulie from Rocky.
I should let you go all the time.
You're busted.
You're busted. You're not a virgin anymore. Now do your Big Pussy.
There's Big Pussy.
Now do your impression. Oh, where I was going with that.
Don't shoot me.
Vito. Vito, you're a guy who likes the movies. You think of yourself as some kind of a file for things.
Yeah.
Give us one.
Well, you just brought up Cheers and Woody. As great as Ted Danson is, I'll still call him Mayday.
I've never once done that. To me, he is Ted Danson and Ted, or sometimes I'll call him Dancing Ted Danson.
What about Becker? You ever call him Becker?
Never once. JP in Georgia.
Movies.
JP.
Turn your radio down. Kids out front should have told you.
Rookie mistake. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Powder. I mean, who's that actor?
Powder was actually Boomtown Saints? Is that the name of it?
Boondock Saints.
All right, Boondock Saints. He was actually one of those guys. To show you what a good actor is, he actually went and played like a cool fucking killer. But I will call any really white kid Powder. John in Texas. John.
Yes, sir. I always refer to the actor that plays Willow as Willow.
The little guy?
Yes, sir. The little
guy. I will say this. I've never really watched Willow. I've seen clips of it. I've probably had it on in the background, but I couldn't tell you a lot about it.
I saw it a couple times as a kid, but I haven't watched it in years and years and years. I remember liking it as a kid because it was like fantastical. So I liked all that shit.
Sandy from Greece never said Olivia Newton-John once. But I feel like she just hasn't been enough since Greece for me to really know her.
But what you don't understand is she was a giant pop star. She was like the biggest pop star in the world. So Olivia Newton-John was way famous before Greece came out. That's why I don't think of her as Sandy at all.
I'm from a post-Sandy world. And Xanadu.
844-ROCK-GOD. I'm just going to throw caution to the wind and jump in here. Hey, you're on the Bennington Show.
Hey, this is Rick from Wisconsin.
Hey, buddy, what's happening? What do you got for us?
Stifler's real name is Sean William Scott.
Pretty good prize closet for you, my man. Michael in Cape Cod.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Monk.
Now, Tony Shalhoub.
I can't call him anything else.
Here's the thing about that. He's done a lot of great work, and he was on a big fucking series even before that, but people do refer to him as Monk now. Jose in L.A.
Yeah. Hey, Napoleon Dynamite.
Here's the weird thing there. Why would anybody even have another fucking reason to talk about him other than Napoleon Dynamite? I mean, he was in that skater movie. John in Long Island.
Hey, how about Gary Sinise, Lieutenant Dan?
I never call him Lieutenant Dan. No. I always call him Gary Sinise. And again, I knew him before that movie. Jerry, Strong Island.
Hey, how's it going?
Yeah.
Chachi. Nobody calls Chachi Scott Baio.
It's a good call. He's fucking Chachi and Chachi for life. I'll give you another one if we're going to do TV. Newman. I have no idea what else he's been in. But you see, he did some 90s movies, and I'm like, The fucking dinosaurs killed Newman.
Yeah, Newman's dead.
Or Newman was trying to look up her fucking dress while he was sweating. He kind of plays Newman no matter what he's doing. And then Newman is one of those guys that he loses a bunch of weight, but he still looks like a fat guy, no matter how thin he gets.
And he got much less work after he lost the weight.
Ed in Philly.
Hey, Ron, how you doing?
Good.
I was thinking of one is a Damone from Fast Times at Ridgemont High. The guy that's always like counseling the dorky kid trying to get girls. And
I wish that I saw him do more stuff. I didn't know that he wasn't the star of that fucking movie. Mama's all right. Daddy's all right. He's so fucking great. Joe in Salt Lake.
Yeah, I got from The Wire, Omar.
Omar from The Wire is a fucking great actor, but he's always Omar.
Always. Always playing a badass.
And I don't know if he's even like that. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I don't think that you could be that street and get as much work that he gets. I think his name was Chalky White in fucking Empire. And yet I'm still like, the fucking Omar's going to get killed again. Tyler in Atlanta.
About Opie Taylor.
Opie Taylor, you know, a lot of people call him Richie Cunningham. He gets called Opie Cunningham even a lot in his life. Mike in New York.
I got Screech.
Now, Screech is a guy who got big. Remember that?
Yeah.
Didn't he fucking...
Yeah, because he started like boxing and shit.
Yeah, and lifting. But he couldn't get outside of the Screech deal.
Oh,
didn't he even stab somebody? Was that Screech?
Yeah, he got into a bar fight after like a gig.
Kyle in Boston.
I'll always be Hawkeye, but Alda,
one of the biggest actors of all time. People still think of him as Hawkeye. Matt in Jersey, what's up, Matt?
Carbone from Goodfellas. Even when he's on The Simpsons, he's still Carbone.
844 Rock God. 844 Rock God. Here's Jim in Jonestown, PA.
Hey, Ronnie, how about Animal House Flounder?
Now, he gets Flounder, but the other guy never got Pinto. You know what I mean?
It just didn't stick.
It was also Niedermeyer.
Niedermeyer, even when he was in a fucking Kiss video. No, wasn't
Twisted
Kiss.
Twisted Sister.
Twisted Sister. He was still fucking Niedermeyer to me.
Flounder was in Babylon 5, too, that terrible sci-fi show.
Jason in Salt Lake.
What's up, Ronnie? And I'm sitting here trying to remember a real name, but Princess Leia.
Princess Leia's real name was, she was Debbie Reynolds' daughter. Carrie Fisher. Let's go over here to Andy in Chicago.
Hey, what's up, man?
Hey.
Joey Tribbiani from Friends.
Well, I don't know his real name. It's Joey, though, right? Isn't he really a Joey?
Yeah, I thought he was really a Joey.
Vito, you're the TV guy. Is Joey Tribbiani, his name Joey?
Matt LeBlanc.
See? I fucked up. I thought his name was Joey.
He looks like a Joey.
And LeBlanc is like a fucking French name, right?
You think he was Chandler?
I guess he thought his real name would be Chandler's, the actor who played Chandler.
Matt LeBlanc seems more like the name sounds.
Oh, okay. I'm getting you. Look who it is. It's the guy that we only refer to as Hard Rock Johnny. I don't say Hard Rock Earl. I know.
Weird.
Your boss is Johnny Gogo.
No, he's not.
We haven't heard from him in a long time.
I always think of Art Carney whenever I see him as Norton. I can't think of anything else. I don't know.
Jim Norton is Norton.
Really? That's weird. I also think
every
of
time
Sean
I see
Penn,
Jim at work, I go, Norton.
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 Hey, pal. I also see Sean Penn only as Spicoli.
No, come on. He disappears in the role.
Seriously, that's my favorite thing, and I don't care how many drug lords he's brought down or whatever he's done, he's always just going to be Spicoli.
He's over in Turkey now making a fucking documentary about that guy getting killed.
Khashoggi.
Yeah, who he says. Sean Penn actually said this. He goes, I know for a fact that Trump held the guy down. Well, they cut his fucking head off with a saw.
It's an amazing doc.
What are you going to do? Look, there's old President Bush going back by train. That's a nice way to travel when you're dead. Train.
Do you know the story why he's on a train?
Him and his friends pulled a train on a girl when they were younger.
That's it. That's how he met his wife.
Why is he on a train?
Because trains have always been a big part of his life, because the only time he ever saw his father cry was when he took him to Penn Station in New York, or Grand Central, sorry, and dropped him off at the train when he was going to war. It's the only time he ever saw his father cry, and so trains have always been a big part of his life ever since.
That's the dullest story I've ever heard in my life.
Brad, that's my presidential trivia for the day.
I mean, when you get like locked into something that should have happened when you were 3, not fucking 18.
Yep, that's the story.
All right, Johnny.
Bennington's. Peace. Good day.
Darren in Minnesota.
Hey, Ron. I was thinking of Ferris Bueller, and then also his wife, Horseface Girl. I can't remember her name.
His wife is Carrie Bradshaw. So it's Ferris Bueller and Carrie Bradshaw together.
I always call Buffalo Bill, the guy who played Buffalo Bill, Buffalo Bill in any other movie I see him in. I don't know that guy's actor. I don't know that dude's name.
Well, when you were saying it, I thought you were talking about the cowboy, Buffalo Bill. And I was going to say, what fucking Buffalo Bill? There's a lot of them. Brandon in Rochester.
Roddy P, what's up, buddy?
Hey.
Bruce Willis. Everybody calls him Die Hard.
I call him Die Hard, too. I never call him John McClane. Matter of fact, every time I try to say John McClane, I say John McCain. And I go, yeah, he was John McCain. And they're like, the fucking senator? And I go, no, Die Hard.
Nakatomi Plaza.
That's what everyone should call him, Nakatomi Plaza. Jay in Ontario.
Same as the other guy. Can't think of his real name, Magnum P.I.
I know. I call him Magnum P.I. too. I don't fucking call him. That's funny that you're calling people just the name of the TV series or movie.
I was always confused as a child between Magnum P.I. and Burt Reynolds. It was a lot for me to handle because of the mustache.
Well, mustache, Chris. It's not that fucking difficult. Did you throw Sam Elliott into the fucking fire? Did Sam Elliott get nominated today? Because there are a lot of people talking about giving him an Oscar. And I was like, whoa, shit. He was barely in a movie. I didn't think they would give him an Oscar. But I guess, you know, everybody's always liked Sam Elliott all these years.
No Sam Elliott.
Who got nominated for the best supporting actors?
Oh, look.
Take a fucking gander, will you, Chris? You got it, Earl?
Alan Arkin?
Yeah, that's one person. Keep going.
Edgar Ramirez, Ben Winshaw.
Nice and loud, like you're on the fucking radio, big man. Like you want to be here.
Henry Winkler.
Yeah.
Ben Whishaw.
What's Henry Winkler up for?
He's reading TV shows.
Oh, my God, Jesus. Earl. What the fuck have you done? You brought so much fucking shame to this show. Go ahead, Vito.
Mahershala Ali for Green Book. Timothy Chalamet for Beautiful Boy. Adam Driver for Black Klansman. Richard E. Grant for Can You Ever Forgive Me? And Sam Rockwell for Vice.
Oh, Sam Rockwell plays young Bush.
Yeah. And he won last year for supporting.
I'm supposed to see Vice pretty soon. When does it come out?
It comes out. I got to check. I know it's okay. December.
Well, we're in December.
Christmas.
Christmas Day. I'm supposed to see it before then. We'll see, though. Jim in Wisconsin.
Hey, Ronnie, Larry Hagman, because he was an I Dream of Teeny, and then I never could figure out when he was JR, he was so much different.
Dallas. So you've completely confused this. You call him Larry Hagman. That's his actual name.
It's the opposite, man.
Yeah. Billy in Jersey.
Hey, Ronnie, $1 million. About Commandant Lassard from Police Academy.
Nailed it, bro. Nailed it. Dan in St. Pete.
Shooter McGavin.
I call him Shooter McGavin, too. All the fucking time. Bruce in Iowa.
Yeah, man with no name from all those spaghetti westerns.
Everyone calls him Clint Eastwood.
Come on. Or at least Dirty Harry. That'd make more sense.
James in Utah.
Archie Bunker. Always will be.
I agree 100%. Carol O'Connor, people just call Archie Bunker. And he's zero like Archie Bunker. But people just call him that. Hey, Earl, remember when instead of reading off the movies, you're reading off the fucking TV shows? And everybody got mad at you?
Yes, that was my fault.
And then you started talking real quiet when you were doing it, too. Like, I don't know, I'm forced to be here. I'm captured right now. Joe in Michigan.
Borat.
Borat is the guy everybody calls Borat.
Yeah.
I don't even know if that was his most popular character, because he had that hip-hop guy before that.
Ollie G.
You would think Ollie G. I bet they call him Ollie G in England since that thing ran in real time. Let's go over here to Steve in Utah.
I got one from Seinfeld. Can't stand ya.
Let's go over here, Freddie, Manitoba. What do you got, buddy?
Hey, Ronnie, how you doing? I got Punch from Chips.
Punch? Yeah, I would do that. Also, I would call the guy from Top Gun Goose, no matter what he's up to. It was always fucking annoyed me that Goose had such a hot chick.
Yeah, that
like
made no sense.
Even the fucking chick that Tom Cruise was chasing, I'm like, why not just take fucking Goose's widow?
You're the ace, man.
And she'd been moving up in this world.
He wasn't thinking.
I don't know. This got sent to us on Twitter. What about Mr. T? I think he was called Mr. T before he did, because Mr. T is his nickname, but he had a weird name on that show.
Oh, yeah, on A-Team.
Yeah.
It was B.A. Baracus.
I was going to call him Bronco. Yeah, Mr. T was just his, and now President T is Donald Trump. He tried to get that going for himself. There's Jeffrey Epstein. What are they doing with him? That's up on the fucking TV. Did they pull Slayton into this?
Oh, no.
There's a picture of him with fucking Slayton wearing a saddle and Jeffrey Epstein just riding him around this fucking thing.
Scandalous, man.
I haven't talked to Slayton in a while, and I haven't heard from Flats for a while. I know he had a foot operation. Then they were going to do a return one, and now I haven't heard from him. Suddenly, I just scared myself. Let me check the obits. Delaware County Daily Times obits.
Flathead.
Bob, you're on the Bennington Show.
Yeah, hey, Ronnie, love your show.
It's good.
How about Fish from Barney Miller?
I always called him Fish, too. The old guy. Abe Vigoda. And he was in fucking Godfather. He was fucking, I think, Tessio. Tessio, yeah. He made the fucking idiot mistake of going up and asking, hey, we want to have a meeting ever. Yeah, my fucking, I'd love to have a meeting with you. My father told me all about it. First person who ever fucking brought up a meeting, kill that fuck.
Patrick Stewart was Jean-Luc Picard to me for a long, long time.
You know, I never watched that one. I never watched Star Trek 2.
That was Star Trek Next Generation. That was my favorite one.
Star Trek 2 was the fucking name of it.
Excuse me, Star Trek 2.
I don't like anybody who says anybody's better than Captain Kirk. You and I just walked away from each other.
Oh, no.
Captain Kirk, I wouldn't even watch fucking Star Trek 2 or Star Trek 3 or Star Trek 4. Because I'm like, what are you doing? You're just fucking ripping off Star Trek from Spock and Captain Kirk. I always called Spock Spock. Matter of fact, I think he even wrote a book like, I am not Spock or don't call me Spock. I mean, when you got to go that fucking far, you're out somewhere getting a burger and people are like, hey, Spock. He's like, look, Spock is a fucking character I played.
I feel like you have to write the book. It's not going to help. People are still going to call you Spock.
My mother always got him mixed up. She always used to call him Dr. Spock.
Who?
Like, we'd be watching Star Trek. Oh, it's Dr. Spock.
Who said this?
My mother. She would always confuse the two.
You know, you bring up your mother so much, it's fucking almost uncomfortable.
It's a weird relationship.
It's like you want to be married to her. Are you, Earl?
No, I'm not married to my mother. Love my mother, but I'm not married to her.
Oh, boy. Brandon. Brandon, what's up?
Hey, I was going to say Anthony Hopkins got a huge career, but he's always going to be Hannibal Lecter.
Maybe to you, but he had done like fucking 30 years of work before then.
He's always the guy from Westworld to me.
Just call him Westworld. I got a little bit of an earache today. Maybe I'm dying. Is that where you feel a brain tumor? Is like an earache?
I'm not a doctor, but I don't think so.
Wait, you're not a doctor?
I'm not a doctor.
Then why are you wearing a smock every fucking day you come in here?
I just look good in it.
Jim, Boston.
Jim, Boston. Herman Munster.
Yeah, that's a good point. He got stuck with that fucking tag. Same with Grandpa Munster. Grandpa Munster used to just call himself Grandpa after that. He owned a comedy club called it Grandpa's.
Yeah, the actor who played Herman Munster hated it. He hated that tag.
What else? Then fucking do something better, Herman. You're the fucking guy who decided to dress up as his comedy Frankenstein. The rest of us have to fucking, are not going to think you as anything else. Don't you think it's awful when people won't be happy with their success?
Yeah, it's weird. I think they
Thank
should.
You.
I think people need to take more time to realize the good things they've done.
That's true.
Original Chris just said, I always used to refer as Neo from The Matrix as Ted from Bill and Ted. So he used one character to describe him as a different character.
Let's take a break here. We'll be right back, Bennington. I can't believe this is the last day of our interns, the Bennington Show. We're saying goodbye to guys that we just barely met.
Yeah, Original Chris and Vinay. It's our last day.
Thank you for that, Chris. Thank you for the fun facts. You know, sometimes like it feels like interns are with you forever. And then other times it feels like... they just come and go so fast, like a karma chameleon. Vito, you set up a big surprise party for them too?
Yeah, they're never going to see it coming.
Who's picking up the food?
Original Chris is going to pick
How
up
How is it going to surprise him if he fucking picks it up?
That's a good point. But
I get an earache in the other ear. That's definitely a brain tumor. I don't think I've ever had in my life to feel like an earache on the right ear, and then a little while later, feel an earache on the left ear. That's got to be sinuses, huh?
Probably sinuses. Build up.
Thank you, doctor.
Do you want me to, like, rub the area below your earlobe?
What would that do?
I don't know. I'm just trying to be helpful.
There's nothing even helpful about that. My earlobe doesn't hurt.
It's internal.
Thank you. Chris, you're nailing all the facts today. All right, I'm going to do something. Chris Stanley is magna cum laude today because he's got all the backup facts. Earl, you're going to be the horse whisperer because you've been whispering all your content today. Lewis, what's up, buddy? It's been a long time.
Hey, what's up, guys? Yeah, man, it's been about 24 hours, I would think, right?
Oh, is that right? Okay. Yeah. I haven't talked to you since yesterday.
Yeah, I know. But
I gotta check in with you in the middle of the night to see how you're doing.
Yeah, that's cool. I'm up. Yeah, but my character is James from Good Times. I've seen him in Die Hard. I've seen him in all types of big sitcoms.
I didn't know
everything.
We were picking that up. Okay. What about Jimmy J.J. Walker? I always referred to him as J.J. And there's a guy that he had to add the J.J. to his name, much like Tiny Zeus Lister had to. So Gail has disappeared a little bit because the baby got the vaccination today and kicked in with a little bit of a, I don't know, crankiness. So I've been a little nervous for the past half hour or so. I'm like, fuck, why weren't we anti-vaxxers? Why would you laugh at that, Vito, when I'm fucking petrified? And why is your hat so big? I thought young people did not wear a hat. You know what I mean? Like, their toques are always so much smaller, and you folded it up like your own fucking pants before you leave.
Yeah, because, see, normal beanies are a little too small for my head, so then I get the bigger ones, but I don't have a Chris Stanley-sized head.
Oh, come on.
So I end up having to make this one smaller, and then it just still gets fucked up, and then I get, like, a dick, the head of a penis, it looks like, is on top of my head. It's my hat drama these days.
All right, there's Gail. How's everything going, hon?
Hey, she's doing better. She had a little freak out. She's very uncomfortable, as predicted by the doctor. So, yeah, I think she's okay.
But she's better now?
Yeah, she's better.
Dude, I remember when you were a baby. So me and your mom take you. And I was working nights and your mom was working days. So I had you during the day. And you fucking went into this. I mean, your face was red and you were fucking screaming. And everything was fine when your mom left. It was like a couple hours later.
Yeah.
And I'm like, what the fuck? I was freaking out.
That's exactly what just happened.
That was pre-cell phones. You know what I mean? So, yeah. Like, I was like, I couldn't reach anybody, you know? And finally, like, I don't know what's going to happen. I guess I'll just ride this one out.
Yeah,
everything was fine. Crazy.
Her face was so red. I'd never seen her eyes so puffy. She was just screaming her head off. But I think I got her to be okay now.
I hope it's okay.
Yeah.
Now I'm a wreck.
She'll probably get a little fever, too.
Oh, that's so sad.
I know.
And she was doing so good with her motor skills.
I know. She's so advanced in her motor skills. Well, even the advanced ones fall hard. Even the top baby.
Here's a... I don't know who... They sent a special offer on the Mike Birbiglia thing. 40% off tickets. You can sit in the orchestra for $89. That sounds like a great, and 69 in the mezzanine. That sounds like a great deal, but you can go to the Comedy Cellar for 20. I got to think of what does somebody, you know, remember when the woman who heckled the other night, heckled Louis C.K., it was some fucking place referred to her as a hero. I'm like, that's the hero now, the heckler?
So brave. So brave to yell out in the dark.
Oh, and by the way, we're just talking about people that you only call by somebody. I call Nanette. Nanette. I don't know her real name.
100%. Gadsby, right? Hannah Gadsby.
The Great Gadsby, yeah.
But like, it took me a while because I was like, you know, remember the part when Nanette said this?
And I guess... Nanette was some girl who dumped her that has nothing to do with even any of the stories. So Nanette was speaking the other day, and she wants good men to stop talking about bad men. Just shut up when it comes to this.
Like they're Voldemort.
And I go, and I'm like, then Nanette must fucking love me.
I like the idea is like, good men shut up, bad men shut up, just shut up, men. Shut up.
That's what? Somebody turned around and go, hey, why don't women shut up? That's what started all this. What? Here's this person who says she doesn't want to hear anybody else's fucking free speech. Let's remind you of something, Nanette. A, you're from Australia, all right? You're over here in the fucking 50 states. To me, you got here on a caravan. B, Pablo Picasso is the Miles Davis of painting. That's when you lost me. I don't even know what else you said. That's it. That's all I got to say. Oh, and I'm against bad men.
Can I tell you the one thing that really bothered me about her special? Mm. And it's not really just her. It's just everyone from where she's from. Van Gogh? No. I don't like Van Gogh. Van Gogh. We say Van Gogh.
And then the some Europeans would be like Van Gogh.
Yeah,
but
I don't
she
like
even
it.
Went in a totally different way.
Van Gogh.
Is the original Chris here? Vito, just fucking answer me.
Oh, yeah, he's right here.
Yeah, send him over here. Get over here. Why this team moves so slow? Now, Earl, I think you can't bring in your low energy. I want you to focus on that. Chris, stop trying to summarize. Everyone go back to acting like people. All right, we're talking about your fucking... greatest Australian, Nanette. Right?
Yes.
Is she the number one comedian in Australia?
I still have Jim Jefferies ahead of her.
Really?
Yes.
Surprising. Jim Jeffries, nothing bad ever happened to him. Now, how big was she before Nanette happened over there?
I saw a lot on, if you go to like the Melbourne Comedy Festival and that sort of stuff, she'd normally have relatively big shows there. She'd be on a lot of those TV shows that you'd have at home where they have the panel of comedians and that sort of stuff. So
what do they talk about, Australian comedians? What do they panel up on? The news of the day?
Yeah, there was a bunch of different shows. There was shows like, I'm sure you've had some sort of similar shows over here. They had like, Thank God You're Here. They had a lot of actors come on there.
What would they do? What would they say? Thank God You're Here.
That was
welcome
like,
to Thank God You're Here. Tonight's Jim Jeffries is here. Nanette
exactly.
is coming out on stage and a kangaroo.
So Nanette is pretty big. Like if you compared to her as a band, would she be like the same as Powderfinger?
Is she the Powderfinger?
I think Powderfinger as a band is a little bit bigger than Nanette as a comedian.
All right.
Okay, got it. Now I understand.
All right. So the biggest comedian over there is Jim Jeffries, which, by the way, he told me before, he's never gotten a lot of respect in Australia.
Really?
He feels like Australia pays the least respect for him out of all the continents. Yeah. He says he draws better in Central America. He says when he's playing Costa Rica, because I know your girlfriend's like, Chris, man, can we get tickets to see Jim Jeffries?
Huge fan.
He's so good. When he talks about the little chihuahua on the back and his head is bobbing back and forth.
She loves that in heavy metal. That's just her people.
Now, did you see this thing that Nanette, I guess she's prime minister?
Close.
Is she the prime minister? And you guys don't use guns for anything in Australia.
Correct. Not for a long time. We had a mass shooting in the early 90s, and the government said, no, that's it.
How do people protect their homes? Blow guns? Is that
just
what you do?
Lock the door, and then lock that's the about door. It. That's all you need, isn't it?
So you don't, like, you think we're gun crazy over here?
Compared to us, yeah, definitely.
Right. That hurts. First, Nanette. Now this. You think Nanette's going to win the Comedian of the Year thing running around? She's certainly the most talked about, Chris.
I think she is. I have a feeling.
What do you think, Gail? Is there anybody that could beat Nanette this year?
No, I think that that was such a huge wave in comedy. It started such a big conversation. I think you've got to put her up there as a contender.
I've had two very, very famous comedians say to me, off air, they hate that special, but no one says it on. Like younger comedians who've got nothing to lose.
Yeah.
They say, no. Now, I said this to when I was with Jerry Seinfeld and Ricky Gervais. I said, Nanette is never going to do anything bigger than that special because now we see her coming. And that special was shocking. And Seinfeld said to me, he goes, that's not fair, Ron. He goes, that's not fair. It's true, but it's not fair. And that made me laugh. I said, Jerry just got edgy. And then he went back to just making Ricky feel bad for having a show. He was hard on Ricky. So this could be the year of the Australian. I think Jim Jeffries was our comedian the year before, right?
Yes, he was, yeah.
Yeah. It's going to be all Australians from this point on.
We're getting
this
it done.
This is embarrassing. Yeah, they're taking all of our acting jobs and now this.
They are. They've taken all the acting jobs. They travel constantly. They don't go back to Australia. I went to Australia once. There was like 17 fucking citizens there.
Yeah. We love to travel.
Yeah. And all
which makes it hard if you're traveling because it always feels like you're at home because regardless of what hostel you go in, 90% of the people there with you are also Australian.
That makes it a nightmare.
Yeah. You want to get away from those people.
Yeah, you go to Egypt, you're seeing the pyramids, and people are like, you want a party tonight? Like, dude, I'm trying to be part of this. But where does that wanderlust come from? Why are you guys always on, as you call it, the walkabout?
I don't know what it is. I just think that we're so far removed from the rest of the world, and there's not that many, I don't know. I just feel like we're kind of bred into us when we were kids that, you know, rather than having a lot of money, having a big house and all that sort of stuff, you go on holidays. That's what you spend your money on. You work.
It's brilliant.
So you can go on holidays. That was especially how I was raised with my parents.
Yeah.
We never had the biggest house or the best car or whatever, but we went on a shitload of holidays. We went overseas a bunch when I was a kid. And that's kind of
the way
that it
straight up. It just gets into your system.
Absolutely.
It is an interesting, it's what Americans act like they're like, but they're not.
Yeah.
Americans are like, I have three hot tubs. And I'm better than my neighbors. But when I ask, because anytime my crowd work, there's a fucking Australian. So I'm like, well, how do you, you know, and they're like, we've been out for 9 weeks. And I go, how do you afford it? And they don't have an answer. They fucking lie. They're doing something. They're dropping off drugs, something. And then I'll be like, somebody from Canada, how long you been here? 4 days. When are you going back? Tuesday. And I just turned around to Australia. See? That's the way the world works. What? How do your jobs even have so much time?
Well, that's the thing I've noticed about the States as well, is there's so little time that you guys have off, 2 weeks or whatever it is per year, whereas back at home we get 4 weeks at least, sometimes even more. So it allows us to go on holidays a lot longer. And
yeah, but first of all, it takes you 2 days to get anywhere.
That's the
and then
thing
2 days to get home.
That's why we go on holidays for so long. It takes 24 hours to get here. We're not going to come here for a week and then go back home because half the trip is spent traveling. So you want to come here. And a lot of people will say, well, it's a once-in-a-lifetime type trip. We're only going to do this once, maybe twice if we're lucky, in our entire lives. So we're going to make the most of it. We want to go for 5 or 6 weeks. I have come for a bit longer, but that's all right.
Yeah, but you guys are also comfortable sleeping on the floor, sleeping outside, sleeping in the back of a truck. Yeah.
Whatever it takes.
Yeah. We're like, how many suites do you have?
Yeah, they're very comfortable in hostels. Very.
I love hostels. They're my favorite thing about
I've never walked in one in my life.
The ones I've been to are good. There's a couple of dodgy ones, but there's a few that I've you know.
Let me ask you this. Is a Four Seasons considered a hostel?
Not quite.
Then I've been in one.
Not quite.
Okay. I want 24-hour room service. I want full fucking every. If I'm in a place that I came
Uber
to buy
Eats.
Movies,
Uber Eats is kind of like room service.
Oh god, Uber Eats is a nightmare. Vito's not even using it today for your surprise party.
I know.
Doesn't trust. Why didn't you use Uber Eats? Why would you send the kid, Vito?
It's. I got a delivery person to do it.
Oh, they are bringing it.
Yeah, they are bringing it.
All right, because you just told me you were sending him.
I know, because it wasn't coming up as delivery online, but when I called, they said they would do it. Like, the computer wouldn't let me put it in, but they were fine actually coming once I spoke to them.
I bet it doesn't happen.
No, it's going to happen.
This is dodgy.
It's going to happen.
Dodgy.
And Uber Eats we don't use because one time it was a disaster. And we just, I'm not never trusting them again.
Yeah, that was a disaster. I remember that day. I ended up having to run out for a pizza.
Oh, yeah, they were supposed to come down from Harlem.
Yeah.
They said they just eventually threw the food out the window.
Yeah.
Scumbags.
So that's the downside. You should have even known. You can't get around this neighborhood today. This fucking Christmas neighborhood.
Yeah. But this is probably a bike, I'd imagine. Not a car.
Where are you picking the food up?
It's from 3rd Avenue and 43rd. So
you're right.
We'll be fine.
I hate the bikers, and I was in a fucking car the other night, and it was like being in a movie. How fast this fucking idiot on the skateboard went in front of us. It was like a fucking, like he was a movie, like he was jumping cars.
Was it one of those electronic ones that people use now?
No, it was a fucking skateboard.
A lot of those have motors now.
He told
it
you
was a fucking skateboard. I know what a skateboard is, Vito. I don't know why you treat me like I'm grandpa who doesn't understand.
No, I'm just commenting that skateboards have motors now.
Did it look like a surfboard with wheels?
You know what, Vito? You tell every dumb story in the world, and I don't fucking interrupt you and say, did you get a detail wrong?
I was just asking.
I can see the guy was... No, you weren't asking. You were demanding. You were demanding that I change my story.
That was very aggressive.
This isn't some fucking Australian chat show where you can just say, who's lying? Welcome to Who's Lying? It's Jim Jeffries, Nanette, and a kangaroo. You ever saw a fucking kangaroo in the wild?
Heaps of them, all the time. We have a beach house, and we get them in our front yard, in our backyard, in our beach house all the time.
You shoot them? You guys don't have guns?
Of course not, no.
What about a wombat?
I haven't seen a wombat in the wild. I've seen them in zoos. I've never seen them in the wild. But kangaroos are a lot easier to find because they're a little bit bigger.
I don't know what a wombat is. Let's take a look.
They're adorable. I'm obsessed with them.
They look like they move slow. That's a groundhog. A giant groundhog.
It's huge, though.
It's a groundhog and a pig, in this picture at least.
Do you see that fucking pig on the iBank today? That Franken pig or Franken swine?
No, what is this?
Dude, first of all, it's the most disgusting muscular pig you've ever seen. I mean, I freaked out. And they're selling sperm so you can put it in your fucking pig and make it even big.
No.
Pig sperm.
It should be Franken swine, Chris. In the IB wire. Oh, it's horrific. It is horrific. Oh, by the way, you can get t-shirts.
Go to ibangshop.com, ibangshop.com to get the brand new Bennington Show t-shirt. That's ibangshop.com.
Oh, my God. This pig is really disgusting.
Is that horrifying or
what?
That
is so gross. I have chills right now. That's really gross.
It's like
really
a human
gross.
Pig of some kind.
Yeah, that's the thing that really bothers me.
Now, would you buy the sperm and put it into your pig?
I guess I'd have to.
No.
I don't want my pig being beat up by others. Doesn't it look like a man's back? Like
it
a
does.
Man's back?
That's horrifying.
Here's the other thing that just the fucking width of the asshole. Like you could easily put a normal sized pig into the asshole of this.
They can't be selling the sperm. You don't want more pigs like this.
Look at the tail. Look at the way the tail looks. Like it can't just rest because it's like covered like all the muscle around it. So it's just like weirdly erect.
It's up like a hard on, like a fucking guy with a broken dick.
Oh my God. I hate it. I hate it so much.
The
it kind of reminds me of
the Chinese are fucking around with any kind of genetic stuff until you're going to see a kid that looks like that.
No. Then we have to put it down.
All right. Now, I know you guys aren't. Wait a minute. I want to get into this other story. But Rich in New Jersey is telling me something ridiculous. Rich?
It's not ridiculous.
Don't lie, dude. What you're telling me is scaring me.
Look it up. It's either a wombat or a wallaby. Well, one of them. When they poop, it's a cute instead of a.
That can't
like a
be true.
What? Wait, when they poop, it's what?
A cute.
Look it up. Have them look it up.
It looks like charcoal.
What animal poops cute?
No, it's a fucking wombat. I've never seen this. That is squared off.
That is fucking.
Oh my God. See? Even more adorable.
Fucking marsupials.
Yeah, but now I do believe in God. Girl, congratulations. Because there's no way nature could have that happen.
I am horrified right now.
Does that mean their butthole is a cube like shape or
maybe just their colon, like their intestine, is cube shape and have to push it through a round fucking hole? Put in Wombat's asshole so we can get a good look.
Okay, Wombat asshole. Oh, this doesn't bring up a Wombat that's a jerk.
Oh, good joke, Chrissy. You made a real attempt. I bet in fucking 3 weeks when you retry that joke.
Hope Wombat's come back up.
I'll laugh.
What is this?
Oh,
the next Wombat?
He'll
just try to work it in.
There's too much fur to even see the asshole.
Now, Earl, you're a religious boy, right?
Yes, I'm a spiritual person.
Would you call yourself a Jesus boy?
Yes.
Now, this surprised me. So all the presidents are together, right?
Yes.
And they did the Apostles' Creed. And everybody was saying it. Now, by the way, if you're at a funeral, it's written on the thing. You can just read along. Every president, every first lady was doing it till you got to Trump. And then Twitter and all the things were like, okay, he's supposed to be the Christian guy, the Christian right, but he doesn't know the Apostles' Creed. And then I was surprised because I didn't think it was something that Protestants say.
Yeah, we've never read the Apostles' Creed. I thought it was a very, it was more in the Catholic Church.
You're just repeating me now.
And I was shocked to see Obama read it because he was considering himself a Protestant.
Yeah, but you know what? I was thinking this. If I was in a church, I would try to go along with no matter what the church was.
Oh, I always go with a bit.
Yeah,
I do it like, you know, if there's a Jewish service, you do what they do.
I actually prefer it to my own because you can just like, I'm being a nice person. But then when you're with your own church, my mom is like, you're going to go to the midnight mass? And I'll go, they rape kids, mom. They rape them. But if you said to me, would you go to some other church? I go, of course. Be very nice. Hey, guys. I like to wave to people when they're going by on a little tour for themselves.
They love it. They love getting a wave.
Yeah.
But I think even beyond
like
him.
A wombat.
Yeah. Beyond him not knowing, it was that it was in front of him and it seemed like a choice not to say it.
He would not do a prayer and he would not sing a hymn. And his wife was the same way. And that had people freaking out. They were going crazy.
Yeah, that's very disrespectful.
But the Apostles' Creed, to me, it's the best prayer because it has the best rhythm to it. It's just like a beautiful rhythm. So I always enjoy that in church. Do you agree, Gail, or disagree?
Yeah, I do. I it's very poetic. It's one that is like has, well, it's like a good mantra. It's like the same, it's right. That same good feeling you get if you're oming with people. I think, you know, that it's just like it puts you in a good mental space.
But that's the other thing about Trump, whether you like him or not. You got to say, he's such a weird cat. He's at the Bush funeral with the other presidents and he wouldn't go along and do it. And he's the guy that, like, the Christians are like, we're so in favor of him. What about the divorce and the cheating? Ah, he's different.
He's better now.
It's a different kind of dude.
Yeah, the white evangelicals. I can never say that word. They always had they're ride or die with this guy. He could kill someone, and they'll be like, well, he maybe
shoot
had a
somebody con. On Fifth Avenue, Harl. I got the feeling that Earl shits in a cube. He's a fucking wombat ass.
Oh, my mud is strong.
What the fuck?
Oh,
disgusting.
Earl.
What does that even mean?
Disgusting.
Means it's normal.
But why would you call it strong? Like we couldn't break it with a stick?
No.
Like, or like, is it the force in which it exits your body?
Yeah, I do get a little violent when I hit, when I go, I really go.
Oh God. You are fucking, and he says when, like it's a rare thing. And then his ass.
When I
just
finally
explodes.
Do. Oh boy,
it's like
step
a full
back.
Moon.
Oh, Chris. It's compacted.
Horrifying.
It's compacted.
Horrifying. Vito, where's this food at? What time's the party start?
I believe Vito went down to get it.
I'm coming home, so we better get this party started. I hope that's the Christmas
Sounds
song
fine.
In England this year. I hope that's the... No, I don't know whether you're familiar with this, but in England, who's ever number one at Christmas, it's the most special thing. We don't have it in this country.
No, not at all.
If we did, I'm sure Thank You Next would be it.
That'd be too. That yeah. It's just like their song of the summer is the song of the winter. Like we have the song of the summer, but their song of the winter is their Christmas song.
But we know what's going to get it this year.
I'm checking their charts right now.
Why are you checking their charts? When you see it's if somebody has just done the prediction, because you never know. And now they do it for charity, so charities get behind it. I hope it's Thank You Next, but I think they never pick non-English people, or at least non-British Isles.
Sorry, so find a list of all the past Christmas songs.
Why?
I'm not seeing anyone picking this year's yet.
What was last year's then, if you're doing past?
All right, last year was, that was 2017. Last year was Santa's Coming for Us by Sia.
I'm not even feeling it. What was 2016?
All right, 2016.
Why aren't they in a fucking...
I don't know. This is a strange order.
No, you're just getting the Christmas songs, Chris. You're not getting the thing.
You're not getting
top of the
pops. It doesn't
necessarily have to be a Christmas song. Yes.
British charts, it is Ariana Grande. Just
clear your fucking throat. It sounds like you got to take a shit again soon. When you go, you really explode.
It is Ariana Grande. Thank You Next is the number one song in the world.
Oh, my
too.
God. Did you just hear what he just said? What are you, hitting puberty?
Next.
Now, when you first met Earl, were you surprised he didn't have a didgeridoo and a fucking rain stick? What are the native people there called?
The Aboriginals.
Now, they have no connection to Africa whatsoever.
Correct.
Isn't that weird?
Yeah.
Is there another place where there's black people that can't say African, they came from Africa?
I can't think of one. Maybe Pacific Islands, maybe?
I don't consider any of those people black, though. They're way more brown.
But I
they're
can't
Asia connected, in my opinion.
Yeah.
But outside of that, I can't think of one.
I mean, they had to have come from Africa at some point. But how? Walking?
No. Great
swimmers.
What about the native people in New Zealand? That's different than the Aboriginals.
No, I think they're the same, aren't they?
The same?
I think they're different because they're more like... from what I know of the New Zealand indigenous people, I think that their culture, their belief systems and all that sort of stuff are different to the Australian.
All right, let's take a look at those folks and see what they're called. They're the ones that do the crazy.
Yeah, the haka.
Yeah. Everybody loves them.
Oh, I love it.
The Maori.
Do you ever...
Maori. Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
But they're not black people. They're more brown people.
Yeah.
Where the Aborigines, they're as fucking black as Harlem, Earl.
Yeah, I mean, this is a stumper. This is a real stumper because I'm trying to figure out where.
You know what? Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe they're not as black as I'm letting on. I'm looking at them now up close. Let's see. There may be just a deeper brown, Earl, like some kind of Mongolians. They got fucking lost, got an extra tan, but they don't look African to me. Am I wrong, Earl?
No, you're not. They don't look as African as, let's say...
They look closer to Eskimo.
Yes, very much so.
Like some kind of an Eskimo who's on the wrong side of the world. Australians are terrible to them, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
We bypass race in this country, and we're proud of it.
I have noticed that. It's a lot better than at home.
Thank you.
Definitely.
That means a lot to me.
It's nice to hear.
Nice to hear from all of us. Hey, John, what's up?
Hey, guys, what's up?
Hey.
Happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas to you, my friend. I'm fighting the war on Christmas this year. If you got a war on Christmas, I've got a war on you.
Finally, I got no war. I hear you. Hey, guys, did you get my little Christmas gift?
We'll have to check the mailroom.
Why don't you check the mailroom every fucking day, maybe twice a day? Maybe while Vito is downstairs, he could check the mailroom.
Vito said he got it the other day.
All right, then I will text Vito and make sure he has it.
You guys don't talk about these things? These things should be presented to us on the air. Well, you know when he's wrong, he gets quiet.
It's very wrong.
You're very clippy today. You're very short. You're redundant. And then when I ask you something about that, you just... That thing that you do where you just act like you don't hear it. Oh, that's bad radio. Earl, that's fucking wombat radio. Earl, I found out from his doctor, shits a wombat and then that wombat shits cubes.
Oh my God.
It's like one of those dolls. Are they called?
Russian dolls.
The Russian.
Babushka. Babushka dolls.
Yeah, but there's like something they say. It's got a fucking name to it. I can't think of what it is. Like a tracking, like a packing, like a sacking, stacking doll.
Starts with an M, I think.
Starts with an M.
I feel like it starts with an M.
That's the odd thing.
Stacking sounds good.
Nesting dolls.
Nesting dolls. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's an M.
That's close.
Nesting. Helpful fuck. Earl, I'm going to send you I'm being told that we don't have anything from the mailroom. That mailroom is a fucking disaster, Earl. That could be your thing in 2019. You can go down there and go old school postal. You know what I mean? Just go postal. Now, Australia and New Zealand hate each other, but Australia doesn't know it.
Exactly, because they're the little siblings, essentially.
Right.
Like, we don't know that there's a rivalry, but they think there is.
I think they're your Canada.
Exactly, 100%.
Yeah.
100% our Canada. We're better than them at most sports. Their rugby is kind of like hockey here. Sometimes,
right.
You know, the Canadians might get the better of the States in hockey. Sometimes they'll get the better of us in rugby union. But apart from that, we've pretty much got them covered in everything else. We don't need to call it a rivalry because we are just the superior nation.
What nation you think is more beautiful?
I've never been to New Zealand, but it's Australia. I don't need to go there.
Why would you travel over New Zealand? It's one of the most stunning things I've ever seen in my life. The movies that are shot there are just all inspiring. You fly over that place.
Yeah, because it's. I feel like I can just go there whenever I want. It's close enough to Australia that I can kind of just have
a
weekend
boat, right?
Out of it. You can take a boat, you can take a plane, you can swim, you can do whatever.
It's
but,
like us going to Kansas City.
Yeah.
You're like, I'll get to it.
Yeah, exactly. It'll always be there. Whereas if you want to come to the States, you want to go to Europe, you kind of have to plan for that stuff. And if you have an available couple of weeks or you want to plan for a holiday at some stage, you're going to go there.
Now, Vito looked like he put his face to the thing. I waved him in and now he's just standing out there.
Oh.
Surprise.
Look at that.
Ow!
Hey.
Ow!
Look at this. Thank you, Vito.
This is our...
So this one's just for me, is it?
No, it's you and Zanette.
Nice. I'm excited.
You really... Oh,
and drinks.
Vito,
man, I could get used to this pampering.
Yeah, he is pampering you. Now, explain what we have here, Vito.
These are meatball subs from Terry's Midtown.
Why
NYC.
Did you pick that?
I read that they had one of the best meatball subs in the city, and I thought we'd all like
to try it. Where's Vinay at? It's his day. Why wouldn't you bring him in?
Earl, send in Vinay.
I don't know whether you've noticed this, Chris.
Yeah.
Vito is not nice to Vinay. And I was talking to the other Chris.
There's a bit of tension.
Is there a bit of tension? Yeah. Thank you.
100%.
Because they both say no to me. No, don't stand in the middle. Sit down, Vinay.
Whenever I try to bring up Vito in front of Vinay, he just goes a bit quiet. And he just doesn't quite know what to say.
Something happened there.
I have a great deal of respect for Vito.
I see that you're doing the public thing, but you came in here gangbusters, and something happened between you two guys, and even Vito is being quiet now, and Chris has picked up on it himself. Vito, you have to talk.
I'm just giving everybody their sandwiches.
What? You literally can't hand out a sandwich and talk.
I was just counting to make sure we had it all. Look, it's just, I like when my interns...
There's seven. How hard is that to count?
Well, I like when my interns do as much as what I ask them when to do it, and sometimes Vinay has to be told things over and over again and still
like
messes
what?
It up.
What do you have to tell him?
How many times have you lost my credit card?
I've had it twice. I didn't lose it. I kept it in my wallet.
Yeah, I've had it in
my wallet.
I've had to call him to bring it back the next day.
But
three
that's
times.
It. That's it.
Three
it
was, times. It was,
no, twice.
Three times.
It was twice.
Ask Chris. Chris?
It was three times that I had get texted.
And
from
one
Vito.
Time he said to
money.
Chris in response, oh, LOL, my bad.
I said,
what do you want him to say?
I said, I'll come back.
What
did
you, we should have had a teary eyed emoji?
No, it's just, it's a little careless with my.
You know what I've noticed with you fucking millennials? There's no napkins. This thing is real. Were you glad that he hopped up and got the napkins with you?
Yeah, it was really nice.
Vinay, are you feeling any of the same stuff towards
No, I Vito. Love Vito. Vito's a great role model, a great friend, been a great superior and boss.
I say every day, I am not a role model.
That's your mantra to the interns every day?
In the mirror?
Do as I say, not as I do.
Thanks, man.
Now, do you get along with Chris? Original Chris?
Yeah, me and original Chris, we talk basketball, you know. He tells me about Australians that are in sports.
None of this has to do with work. That is a big problem
also,
for you as a mentor.
Original Chris rarely has to be told things twice, does everything right the first time.
Like
he's 7 years older than me.
That's so
much. No, I'm just saying I'm learning
it's
how to do this.
See you.
I'm 21.
Yeah, you can't use I'm a child as an excuse. Are you a rich boy, Vinay?
I'm decent. I'm fine. Okay. I was an only child. That's where
you
I
have
spoiled.
The demeanor of a rich boy. Like everything's okay.
I thought my whole vibe was the world is gonna end.
No,
I'm not happy.
I'm not picking up on that.
Oh,
but I do. I have heard from a different person than Vito, basically that you can't tell Vinay nothing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
The comedian said to me, this kid doesn't listen. He's going to do whatever. I tried to take him on.
Just won't take
him. You just can't.
Place.
You cannot talk to him. He's on his own thing. I go, well, you don't know. Maybe he'll break through. You know, maybe he's a total original. But I do have a problem with Vito when I go, where's Vinay? And I hear that he doesn't talk sports with you. That's a bad sign.
No, that was just, I was just bringing up some of the positives of Chris as a person. But like I said, Chris does everything he's told. He listens. I don't have to correct him that much. I think anytime I've corrected him, the next time it has not happened again.
Who picked out this meatball place?
I did.
Let me just say this. That's one of the worst fucking meatball sandwiches I ever tasted in my life.
Yeah, I did my research this time, and it seemed like it was going to be better than this.
There's a fucking place just called the Meatball Shop. Why do you want to go beyond it?
Did not think of the Meatball Shop.
It's famous.
I know. Meatballs. I thought for some reason it didn't. I didn't think because I didn't think Meatball Sub Shop.
And yet you're going to say that this kid doesn't make good decisions. He doesn't listen. This fuck. You know what this tastes like? Like we lost a war. And they're rationing.
So bad.
I mean, I'm sitting here going, how can you fuck up a meatball? You feel just upset now?
I'm pretty pissed at this place and my judgment.
So you felt the same way. You tasted it.
Yeah, it's not the best sandwich. Sorry, Terry's.
Why are you sorry to
that? Sorry, Terry's, but you guys fuck this one up. Should have just went to Parm. I wanted to go to Parm, but I wanted to switch it up.
Why? Why risk it?
I don't know. I thought, you know, let's be different. Let's be jazzy. But this is not good.
Look, I like jazz. We should have went to Lincoln Center. Now the Australians are eating it because they don't know where they're going to eat again. What's the strangest country you've been to, Original Chris? You've traveled the world.
The strangest country. I don't know. This one's pretty weird.
It is,
but. I've only been to probably like six or seven others, so this is probably the weirdest.
What's the weirdest thing about America? Our weird fucking meatballs.
The weird meatball sandwiches, can't get my head around that.
You know the difference between meatball and Play-Doh, right?
Yeah. I do. I don't know if they do.
Oh, look at her. She's not feeling good today.
I know. It's heartbreaking.
Oh, that picture just kills me, Gail.
I know.
You put feeling better, but you're not sure. Is she sleepy? Please keep an eye on her. Aaron in Boston. Aaron, what's up?
Hey, Ronnie. Love the show. I just want to stick up for the Kiwis out there. And it's tough to hear an Australian guy that can't even travel to the country right across the pond there, start to slam it.
Now, you're a Kiwi guy? You like them?
I've been fortunate enough to live there and travel to Australia. And I think, what are there, 14 or 15 things in Australia that can kill you besides the horrible drivers? Nothing in New Zealand that you have to worry about.
We like to keep people on their toes, that's all.
Yeah,
I don't pick a place by their lack of snakes, but just like when I see those mountains and everything in New Zealand, it's just gorgeous. I mean, Lord of the Rings, no, they didn't even have any CGI.
No.
There were fucking elves living there.
My buddy just got back from New Zealand and said it was phenomenal.
You ought to sit and think about fucking meatballs before you move on to New Zealand. It's crushed you, huh?
Yeah.
You always do so great with Parm. We always made a big deal. Like, Vito did it.
Not today.
He brought his Parm.
Today I brought you.
Vinay's eating the shit out of it. He's making you look like a rock star, and you don't have anything for this kid.
I need my interns to live up to my standards.
This is your fucking standards.
That's
right
not
here.
My standards. It's Terry's has not lived up to my standards.
Well,
This is jail food.
I should have just had my family make it.
Alan, Sacramento.
Hey, Benningtons.
Yeah.
You know, I noticed that Vito's attitude towards Benet changed when he started being more forceful is probably too strong a word, but about his own comedy ambitions. I think they took some sort of umbrage. That.
Do you think he was a little jealous of you, Vinay? Jealous that you're...
I'm not sure if jealousy is the right word, but yeah. It describes the word that I'm looking for.
Yeah.
Right.
So when he found out that you were an ambitious young comedian, and you were meeting the other comics, and I thought it was a very positive, fun thing, you took it as a negative.
No, it has nothing to do with his comedy. It's just he doesn't do a good job as an intern. That's what it is.
I was pissed at him for going up to comedians like his second day in, asking to book him on his show. I felt like he was trying to use us for his show.
That's all part of interning.
No, that's not part. You can't be mixing the two businesses. You got to keep things separate.
Do you feel like he bypassed you almost immediately?
No, he did not bypass me. He can't even open Adobe Audition and do something that simple. He can't phone screen. He gets names wrong all the time.
Wait, what did you just say? He can't open the audition?
Adobe, the editing software.
Okay,
we have.
I didn't know what you were talking about. Open the audition. He says. All right, Vinay. Now this shit's starting to come out. Do you think that you are a bad worker?
I thought I was doing great.
You even said to me you would like to come back and do another
turn. I thought I was... I mean, apparently I suck ass, but...
Are you going to fail him?
Maybe. It's still on the table.
See, the fact that you can't even make up your decision, I'm going to say this. You're not a man, Vito.
I don't know if...
You're as fucking stringy as your own meatballs that you ordered.
These aren't mine. These are just from a place...
You ordered them. You have to feel... Like, your thing with him is that he doesn't have respect for this, right? Here's the big intern send-off. And it's like, you put dog food on? I don't even know what kind of fucking roll this is.
No, it's not. It's not Italian.
Is it a potato roll?
It looks... All right, this is what it looks like. It's like an Italian bread, but put into a panini press.
Yeah.
That's really weird.
To me, it looks like monkeys had yeast, and they tried to fucking make up their own food.
Is this monkey bread?
No, it's just...
Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
If I was said to Vinay, I want you to fucking have a great send-off lunch today, and this is what he brought in. You'd be flipping out, right?
Yes, I would.
Why are you so easy on yourself?
I'm not. I'm miserable right now that this is what you have.
This makes me believe everything Vinay says.
Why? He doesn't even get... If he fucks up, he just says, LOL, my bad. He doesn't even care.
I'm going to say this.
That LOL really got in your kitchen.
Yeah, it fucking bothered me.
I've had interns lose my credit card in the past. It's just a fucking trigger for me. I don't like it. That girl, Becky, a few semesters ago, lost my credit card and then tried to accuse me that it was in my wallet and that would not check hilarious. Her fucking wallet.
I wouldn't do that to you, though. I was telling you, I had
don't
it.
Don't hold on to that and blame this kid.
No, he lost my credit, but he lost it three times.
He didn't lose it. No.
I just had it in my wallet.
He took it with him a night on the town.
Were there a lot of charges on there?
There were some bar charges on there. Definitely a MetroCard ride on there that I had nothing to do with.
Vinay, come on.
Come on.
He doesn't need to do that.
I'm a rich boy, yeah.
So exactly. You're just getting pleasure off stealing from me.
You're coming across very unlikable right now, but even worse, like a bad boss.
A bad boss would just lie and say he's doing great.
What?
What? Wait, that would be a bad boss.
All right, let me ask you this. Does Chris get a passing grade?
Yeah, first of all, Chris gets an A.
Thank you.
Oh, I didn't even know we did letter grades here.
I give them letter grades to the woman in HR.
What are you giving Vinay?
Incomplete.
What would you give him?
Look, the last time I was in the booth, sometimes I go in the booth, I have to keep telling Vinay to stop looking at his cell phone when he's screening phone
young.
Calls.
He's young.
It doesn't happen.
I know he's young. It has happened, Vinay.
He's a founder.
He's on Grindr.
Vinay, that's on your own time you're on the dating apps.
I did have to tell you to stop tweeting during the show.
That did happen. I admit that.
And then I saw a tweet about you talking about tweeting on during work.
That's fucking meta.
It got a lot of favorites.
See, that's just completely disrespectful.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean it that way. It's just a success for me on my Twitter.
He's a little more easygoing than you. I can see that.
Yeah, this isn't the time. When you're an intern, you're supposed to be working your ass off trying to put the best foot forward.
I admit that's true.
Okay, I took things really fucking hard when I was an intern. I didn't just laugh at Chris when he got mad at me.
How long ago were you an intern?
5 years ago.
And this is the way you're fucking ordering lunch right now. Seriously.
I'm not happy about this. You know me. I love to eat.
Are you eating this?
I've had half, kind of.
You can't even finish it.
I'm in half, kind of.
Chris didn't wolf it down.
The night I'm the only two have eaten it.
Chris,
yeah,
usually,
free meal's nice.
Yeah,
I mean, this is really terrible.
Yeah,
it's pretty bad.
My favorite part.
This is like a squirrel fucked sawdust, and it had a meatball baby.
No, they're small meatballs. They're just breaking apart completely. It's almost like it's a brisket meatball.
What the fuck?
There's barely, you can see where the cheese ends on mine, and it's halfway through the sandwich. They didn't put cheese in the whole thing.
James, I'm sorry, there's the meatballs just stuck somewhere.
This is so fucked. If I was on a jury and I decided between manslaughter and first degree murder, so to speak, I would say, Beto, this is first degree. You sabotaged Vinay on purpose because you don't like him.
It does seem more personal than anything else.
Why would I sabotage somebody that's supposed to be helping me? I don't want them to do bad because then I have to pick up more stuff.
I think it stems when Ron liked having him on the radio and was giving him some time.
I was having a ball with the kid.
Original Chris is on the radio. You don't see me hating him.
No, there was some good stuff about old Vinay. Completely enjoy you on the radio, Vinay.
Thank you. That's very nice of you, man.
All right. You guys have a great day.
I wanted him to do a joke at the...
We ran out of time. There was a time crunch.
Gotta fit him in.
Hey, tomorrow is when Fez debuts as Santa Claus.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
He's born to play the role.
But here's the thing. So he's been watching videos to see how to play Santa Claus, and when he sees how happy the kids are to see Santa Claus, Fez starts crying. His last heart attack has made him very easy to cry, very sentimental, crying immediately, and he's nervous that when he sees happy kids, he's just going to start crying.
They're going to be like, Santa doesn't cry.
I know, that could fuck some kids
up. You never see Santa cry.
Santa's just crying and holding his chest. Look at Vinay, he's just looking down, trying to relive this whole semester and see where it went wrong.
I'd say week 2.
It was the LOL.
There was a Z after it, too. I didn't say that much.
Did it for the lols.
Has Joe List played your club again?
No.
You get any more guys that came in here?
No, not after Joe List.
Who was your favorite comedian who came in who you didn't get to meet?
I didn't get to meet Hari. I didn't get to meet...
That doesn't even make sense.
I didn't get to meet Mateo. I like Mateo a lot. Mateo Lane.
Was Mateo... I couldn't let you meet comedians after you started just trying to book them on your own show. You don't see me coming in and trying to book comedians on the Big Brothers podcast with Chris.
You should. Chris goes outside. He goes to fucking Gas Digital. He doesn't even know fucking SiriusXM exists. I sent that to Jack yesterday.
Why
a long
did you
fucking
say
note.
That?
Because Don covered for you. Now you lost that cover. He's my Vinay. Chris Stanley is my Vinay.
No, I'm
you know,
your Chris.
I want him to be original Chris.
No, just me, Chris Stanley.
No, that's
I'm
our Chris.
Meat, what's up?
Hey, I want to do my impression of Vito when he's phone screening.
Oh, great.
All right. Bennington Show.
All right, breathe heavy, okay? I have fucking sleep apnea. I don't know what's so funny about that.
But it's an odd job to pick when you breathe that heavy. Vinay's laughing at you. Vinay's laughing
you know
at
why
dumb
I have
he's LOLing.
That's why I'm breathing so heavy, because I'm picking up all the phone calls because you can't.
He laughed at your fat face.
He calls you fat too.
Why'd you
earlier.
Have to bring the fat thing into it?
Let's vote on Vinay's grade, all right? I give him an A.
A plus.
You were just complaining.
Yeah, but I like him, though. I mean, well, you know.
I'm going to go F.
Gives him a C. Earl?
I will say B minus.
Yes.
What is that based on?
B minus is almost more confusing than A plus.
What did he have to do to get a B? Where did he go wrong where you're like, no, definitely B minus for me?
I was going to go C, and then, you know, but C is a little cruel. And
yeah, it is.
I didn't expect Earl to give him such a low grade.
Yeah, really. Thought we had a good relationship, Earl.
But B's a
Earl, I think, if anything, you took off because of racism, because you're a fucking
exactly.
Racist.
No, I have no hate towards... I have no.
You're so mad
anyone.
That the Asians have shot past the blacks into the number two movement.
Yes, they have.
Vito, where's the mollies at? I thought we had a little
no,
mollies
other,
dessert.
Other cream puffs from
cream
Deer
puffs.
Papa.
That was all set for a nice Molly's cupcake. These kids don't like cream puffs.
I wish these two would get along. I don't even, oh man, look at Vito running.
When Vito runs, it's horrible.
There's just production guys along that booth, and they all look.
Vinay, tell the truth now. Can you stand him? Is he driving you nuts?
No, I really liked him. I didn't know he hated what? Me so much. Really,
he this said is, it for like.
No,
for
I thought it was a joke. Because I
where's Vinay?
I would always hear like, oh, when they say it on the show, it's just a joke. It's just like a bit. I didn't know there was like pure resentment towards me. Brewing for all those months.
You keep stealing his credit card.
I like having interns on the air because it's like a fresh thing. And the fact that you had a comedy background and you knew these guys, I thought, well, this is excellent. This is great.
Thank you, Ron. I really looked up to you. I learned from you.
I just wish we could have done
more. And Chris and Earl.
Thank you. Well, that's why you get an A+.
Thank you.
Vinay and I barely know each other.
Yeah.
That's true.
Because by the time I came back from maternity leave, he was already banned. I guess the LOL incident already happened.
Yeah, the LOLs.
And that was it. I mean, honestly, yesterday I was like, this is the first time I've seen you in the studio.
Also, Vinay would put out too many waters. I mean, I'm still giving him an A+, but I'll just
you guys tell me to bring that water. You're like, bring five.
Said put fucking six waters out for three people.
Chris,
why are you angry about
it? We were told.
Or, yes.
By who?
By everyone.
By a lot of different, by multiple people.
Three waters. Thank you, Chris. Three
waters.
Three.
Five at the beginning of the semester.
You don't
even know. They said five, and then they said three.
It's, but then it never stopped. It was always six. And then one day you brought in seven. I was like, this is why, let's just bring the fucking sink into this fucking studio.
I, for one, enjoy the extra.
Yeah, I like it. You know what I mean? I like to hydrate. Victor, what's up?
Afternoon, Benningtons.
Oh, we're falling apart.
I just want to, I don't want to get all psychological, but very often when we dislike someone, it's because they possess attributes that we don't like about ourselves.
That is true.
So maybe, Vito, you're mad that you lose your own credit card.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Maybe you're mad that you bring out too much water.
Well, I bring out a very appropriate amount of water.
I know that I would just say, I would just make some like small request, and Vito would be doing it, and I'm like, why aren't you having an intern doing that? And he would go like this, he can't fucking do anything, Ron. If I don't take care of it, you're not going to like it.
It's true.
And you did say that to me.
I did.
Look, he's still getting an A-plus for me, but still, he's getting... The socks incident was a problem.
What?
The what?
The socks incident.
All right, here's what happened, Gail. You were away.
I got, like, pneumonia for this.
Here's what happened, Gail.
You're healthy.
One day, you were out of pregnancy leave.
Mm-hmm.
It fucking rained a flood here, right? So, I get out of the cab, I step into a river, I fucking say to Vito, I go, Vito... is there an extra pair of socks? We used to keep socks here in case anybody during the winter gets their feet got wet. He goes, I'm having Vinay get him. I go, I don't want Vinay to go because he's already heading out. Vinay comes back with socks and there are these tiny fucking ankle socks.
Little girl ankle socks.
They were like, sex? How does that someone know? Not know what a pair of fucking sweat socks are?
No one told me sweat socks.
It's the winter. You would want longer socks to keep warm in the winter.
It was October. It was warm. It was like 70 then.
But it was cold. You just said you had pneumonia.
Didn't say, Vinay, I want Ron to look sexy for us today. Get me something hot. Like, I didn't say that. I said, get me some socks. He's going to have wet feet.
It was from the men's section at Gap. I didn't know it would be sexy on Ron.
You point out
the fact that you guys don't explain yourselves. Yeah. You just use the word socks.
Crew socks. And the crew socks.
You didn't say it. Sweat socks is what I want.
All right. Wrong word.
I would just never assume to get some. You just think people are smart enough to do normal things.
But I thought you were smart enough to try to tell an intern what to do.
Yeah.
What would you give yourself this semester with him?
With him, I'd give myself a D. With original Chris, an A. So we're looking at a B.
You have no complaints over original Chris.
No, original Chris is great. He had a documentary about Australians and baseball.
Did you listen to it?
He wasn't supposed to be doing that this semester. To me, these two are the same kids.
No.
They're just two nice kids. Even now, Vinay's got a nice attitude about all the mean stuff that you're saying.
Sometimes you got to wake up and realize you're in the real world now. This isn't class. This is an internship. You got to take it seriously.
Well, excuse me, Mr. Cliche. Do you want to be dumber?
The hockey thing got in my head today.
I enjoy Vinay.
Yeah.
I enjoy you, Gail.
All the comics like him. And I like the fact that he's a go-getter. He's a fucking booking his own shit. And my man Ezra went to see him, loved him.
Went out of his way saying,
and he wrote to me and said, can we get more Vinay on the show? And I'm like, fuck, I forgot. So I said, hey, Ezra wants to hear more Vinay. Says he killed down there. You're like, he's not ready.
Yeah, not ready. You can't be fucking up on the small things and then get to do the fun stuff. Like,
I've never seen you do this with another intern.
I've never had this many problems with another intern.
We didn't have any problems. You didn't tell me we had any problems.
That's
not
true.
You just implied it on air.
That's not true.
Did you sit down and have a man-to-man with him off air?
How many times did I have to tell you, this is wrong, don't do this, and then you'd say, got it.
I would work on them. There would be different things I would do wrong.
Yeah, no one brought him here because he knows how to do everything.
I came
here to learn. To learn. And then, this is the future of the business.
Yeah, but
this is us giving back to the business, and we have interns. We teach them stuff.
You get told a few things, and then if you don't do those few things over and over again, then it's like, I can't trust you with anything. If I can't trust you with anything, how am I going to teach you other stuff?
You stink at this. I don't pull you off of it. Because it took you a while to get going as the announcer, and you're doing great. He's fucking laughing at you.
No, I'm not.
It took you
crying.
A while. It's okay. Laughing his face. That's good. But now you're a great announcer. But you don't put anything in the dish. You're so dull during that.
I put effort into dish.
Did you listen to it yesterday? You drag the fucking shit out there. You drag it out.
I do work really hard on dish. I research the stories. I try to find stuff.
And you're not there yet, okay? But do I give up on you?
No.
Why are you giving up on this kid?
Because he doesn't try.
Dude, from my point of view, I would say you're not trying. That's how dull you're bringing that across.
But
I'm trying, bro. I really am.
I don't see it. I don't feel it.
It's just I'm not good at shit, I guess, then.
See? He admitted it.
He's good on the air. He did very good on the air.
Yeah, that's one
but
part.
But you kept that away from him.
I kept it away from him so he could get good at the other stuff. I thought it would be a motivation.
At what?
But isn't what's on the air the most important part?
He doesn't want to work at Macy's and pick out fucking socks. Okay? He wanted to interact with comedians.
He wants a sock stylist.
Really are crying?
No. I'm just tired.
Oh, man.
No, I swear to God, I'm not.
Your eyes weren't red a minute ago, and now you're wiping them.
Oh, it's sad that we're leaving. It's ending.
The kid's crying.
I'm not crying. I just have allergies in December. That's what's happening.
You wanted to come back and do another internship, right?
Yeah.
Let's commit to the guy and get a new start and get going. Dude, I didn't know you were this sensitive.
No, no, I just had a bad week.
What happened, buddy?
What's wrong? No, nothing.
Go ahead, talk to us.
I got out of a really long relationship, and it sucked.
You got out, or she got out with you?
She got out!
Yeah.
She did. She was like, fuck this.
Yeah, what happened?
Just long, just, you know, time to move on.
Dude, what are you fucking laughing at, man?
Tom was laughing.
Yeah.
This was just my plan to make him feel real shitty.
I told you guys that I get giggly. If you remember from the bad news that has come up before, and I started laughing. I'm not laughing at him. I'm just laughing because...
Can I tell you something?
Yes.
This kid having a rough time and all, I see that as your failure, man. You're supposed to take care of this guy. Yeah. We're bringing this guy into this business.
Right.
I think he's very funny. I love the fact that he's running stuff. I love the fact that he wants to be here and meet the comics.
Meet the comics is one thing.
Don't let him down, dude.
Yeah, don't. Why are you giving up on this, dude? We all like Vinay.
You want another?
I'm good. I'm watching my carbs.
That's right. You got to get out there and start dating again.
Do what I do. Just get fatter.
Would you have a little empathy instead of acting like, oh, it's funny if I throw him a thing?
I was trying to be nice.
That was nice. Thank you.
I don't know. I can't commit to him right now because I don't know. We could have a meeting and talk about stuff, but I can't commit
to him. You
know what?
Then maybe I can't commit to you, Vito. Is that the way? So should I give up on you?
Please don't give up on me. I need this job, and I like being here, and I love the show.
Right. So this kid is cut out of your cloth.
Remember when you got out of a bad breakup, too?
Yeah. Who was there for you? Us.
You guys were there for me.
Gave you cuddles.
Beautiful therapy session, right?
How long were you guys together, you and her?
4 years.
Wow. That's like 25% of your life.
Right.
And she just walked out for what reason?
I suggested it, which was my mistake, and I half meant it, but I didn't mean it. And then, you know, she played my bluff.
And she's from your hometown? Or
No. California.
Did we see a picture of her?
Yeah, you thought she was hot.
Let me see another picture.
My phone's inside.
Oh, God. You're already deleting pictures. That's smart. Hey, John, what's up, buddy? John.
Hey, I'm actually laughing at Vinay. Not from awkwardness, but my God, he's annoying as hell. And please listen to Vito. You would be riding his ass right now if he didn't get on to Vinay about getting with comedians, and I would love to know what Joe List would give grade on for Vinay.
That would be interesting.
What happened with the Joe List thing?
He went in, he did a set.
Oh, he didn't. Joe backed
out. Joe
said he'd make one up for me.
Yeah, but you don't believe him.
Nah.
Jim in Nebraska.
Hey, Ron.
Yeah.
I think Vito's problem is that he resents you for giving him a hard time.
Oh, is that right, Vito? What are you doing? Fucking kicking the dog when you get home? Is that it?
I'm
fucking see that.
No, that's...
I see that. That's you fucking screaming at me, isn't it?
I'm not screaming at you. I love you.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Then why did you fucking try to poison us all with these meatballs?
I didn't know how
bad
this
is. You're Italian.
I couldn't even finish that. I finished everything.
I couldn't either.
You didn't finish that, Chris?
No, I couldn't, Ron.
That's unbelievable to
me. This has never happened before.
And you wolfed down your cream puff like there's no tomorrow.
I mean, that's delicious. I mean, that's automatic.
Brian, what's up?
I think the problem for Vito is that when this kid gets agitated, his voice goes up real high. You can't really tell if he's male or female, and it's confusing him.
Here's the thing. He's had a tough fucking week, all right? I've never seen a fucking comedian cry before.
Yeah.
I don't know how you're going to make it in comedy.
I don't know either.
You're so sensitive.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm going to hire you a bodyguard.
I mean, if you've been telling how much you suck for, like, the past weeks... Kind of sucks to hear.
I'm glad that you're saying that, though, because you were saying everything's great.
I thought it was like a joke. I thought it was like all in good jest. I didn't know that, like...
That's not a good sign if you think all the criticism is a joke.
Look, can I tell you something?
Yeah.
That air is not radio. You can't just say four words and sit there like a fucking stupid. All right? I'm going to go home with you today. I'm going to talk to your mom.
No, please don't talk to Leslie.
I see you being mean to some of the other kids.
No, she gets really mad about bullying.
Don't be a bully.
Not a bully.
Ed in Denver.
Yeah, Vito is just giving Vinay shit and telling him he needs to get into the real world. And doesn't Vito still live with his mom and doesn't pay rent?
I do pay.
Talking about needing to get into the real world.
New York City, New York. Do you know how expensive?
How much do you pay rent?
Give my mom a few hundred. We got a good deal in our apartment.
You give her a few hundred a week?
Yeah. We got a good deal in our apartment. You got to stay in the same place for a long time.
You believe that he's paying $200 a week?
I think that's a fabrication.
Well, you know how much I love my Leslie. Mom. You know how much I love my mom. Don't you dare.
Are you paying? Are you having cable and electric?
No, I don't. I'm not going to lie to you. I don't pay cable, and I don't think we pay electric.
You pay her $800 a month?
$600.
$150 a week.
It's fucking free, dude, in this town.
I know it is. But
you can bring a girl home?
I haven't done. I've only done that with girls I've seriously dated. The apartment's not big, so bringing home a girl, like on one night, would be really weird.
When's your next gig?
Tonight.
Would you go down and be with him tonight?
Oh, that'd be great.
I got to do stuff tonight.
Please don't.
Just go down, sit there, and fucking see him for the first time.
Don't heckle.
I know you want to do year end stuff, right? Maybe you can interview some people. He works right near the cellar.
I could go to the cellar and maybe stop by, but I was supposed to go to a friend's intramural basketball game.
Hey, Greg, what's up, buddy?
Hey.
Yeah.
This guy's, he's jealous, Ronnie, because you're taking a liking to this kid, and he wants that deep down inside. I'm just trying to beat
you. You know what? This is the thing I like about him. It's the same reason I like Chris, original Chris, and you. You guys love this business. Earl loves this business. Vinay is one of us.
I'm not jealous of any
of
them.
Comedy, radio.
Why would I be jealous? You like Earl. I'm not jealous of Earl.
Does Earl do good work? No. For 20 years, I've had Earl in my life. He can't fucking do anything.
Yeah,
doesn't
Earl's
matter
no
to me.
He's no threat to you.
Who, Earl?
Vinay. You see Vinay as a threat.
No, I don't see Vinay as a threat.
He's a younger, better-looking Vito.
Yeah, skinnier.
Yep. I thought his name was Beret. I thought he was French, named after a hat.
That'd be fucking cool. Gail, what do you think?
I think that Vito needs to break this chain of darkness. They've been mistreating him. I just feel like,
that's not,
you know, bring this kid in. I feel like you got to bring this kid in. Open your heart, Vito.
I don't know.
Open that big old heart of yours.
There's a
dangerously large heart.
Yeah.
There's only been one other intern I didn't want to bring back, and Chris decided against it. And that intern turned around and turned into a huge dick.
What are we talking about?
So I feel like I've said this before.
I think the guy who works for
Jam Band.
Yeah, Jam Band. I was against that or not against
you
it?
I didn't want to bring it back and you did. And I feel like we should. I'm just saying my opinion. I'm just being out there.
Can I tell you something?
Yes.
There was a young guy started with us. Chris not only wouldn't be nice to him, wouldn't work with him. And I tried to say, hey, nobody can go home until all the work's going. Thinking Chris would share the work. He would not. He made the kids sit there while he worked. The guy went on, did other stuff. Chris suddenly became friends with him and was actually in his wedding. So you guys get very weird and territorial in here. And I think you learned it from Chris. I think everything that you're going through, you learned from Chris. And look at him now. That's the fucking ghost of Christmas spirit. You don't want to be this kid.
No. I'm 35 years old.
You are?
That's not the place to stop.
Yeah, I don't know why you think that's the problem.
I want to be 35.
You were an asshole when you were fucking 24. I'm very serious. You won't fucking work the system. Vito doesn't work the system. The same people that you can't interact with, he can't interact with. Why? There's a negativity it takes on with you guys. Just look at this kid. He's the future. He's got a bright, sweet heart. He's not done yet. He goes out and does stand-up every fucking night.
That's outside of here.
That's part of our gig.
Yes,
dude.
It is.
And why wasn't he? Here's the sad thing about Mateo. Remember, we booked him next week?
Yeah.
And we got him a special guest that only he would like. Mateo canceled.
Oh, that sucks.
I did not know that.
That's terrible.
You know why you don't know it?
Why?
You don't listen. That text went out to everybody. You don't answer your text.
I do. I did not get that text.
Chris got it. Gail got it. Earl got it. Each one of them wrote back.
Why don't you guys tell me?
Rocco in Jersey.
Hey, hearing Vinay cry on air took me back to Fezzy crying. Golden days of radio, man. Brought a tear to my eye.
That was a long, strong career that he had. Doing. Now look what he's doing. He's going to be Santa Claus. Crying Santa Claus. He's going to be telling kids, don't grow up. Promise me. Pierre, Virginia Beach.
Buddies.
Hey, buddy.
I think Vinay did a great job. You have two interns who stunk like the last 3 months. I won a pretty good prize closet twice. They just kept blaming Vito, but Vinay has been great. I think Vito's jealous, and I think Vito's been dropping the ball lately.
All right, I don't know why I'd be jealous. The jealousy thing keeps coming up, and I've said I'm not.
Because the kid came in, he was tearing it up, he was getting more airtime than you, he was interacting. Look at his sad face right now. He feels terrible.
People are saying mean things about me. I'm not getting sad.
True.
You're not him. You've been in this longer. Where's your empathy? You're an Italian. Normally, they're the most empathetic people. They like to mentor people.
Not people that, but they like people that don't fuck them over.
How did you get fucked over?
Because mistakes make it harder to do things that I need to do on my own. So then I get caught up having to phone.
You see the way your guy said, this was the guy, because you were cold to him, he's cold to other, Chris.
I never wanted anyone to learn that from me.
And yet they have. So that's what we do. That's how we teach. RJ in Indianapolis.
Okay, Vito, you need to think about it this way. You had one fucking job. Teach the kid and show him the fucking ropes. But instead, you want to be a fucking dick to this kid. I mean, look at him. Do something proud. Think about it. If you would teach this kid something, and then he makes something of himself, you would accomplish something for once.
That's
besides
true.
Your fucking horrible you comic my career, manager, man. If you want to call it that.
My horrible what?
You're his comic career.
Oh. Yeah, I feel like you're acting like a teacher who's never had a kid that failed.
Not failed because the fucking teacher was mean to him. No one had fucking respects that.
I'm not mean to him.
You know what?
Also, can I tell you teachers something? Don't fail people because they lose their credit cards.
Right.
I didn't lose it. It was in my wallet.
It was in your wallet, not in my wallet. That was the problem. Three times. But that's just one thing. There's a bunch of things.
But I even feel like if you went and said, I want to fail this kid for his internship, and then they asked you why, and there's like personal reasons involving my wallet.
There would be other. I've brought up other stuff, though. It's not just the credit card. That was just one of the big tipping points.
Look, here's the thing. If I was a teacher, and I never have been one.
Yeah.
If that kid fucking failed history, I still wouldn't want to fail him. You're the one being represented here. This kid come into our business wanting to learn it. He's an NYU, so he's not a dumb kid. You know what I mean? That's a tough school to get into. And he's running his own comedy thing. I say we don't let this guy down.
I've just seen so many mistakes over the course of the semester. And I don't want to repeat all of those mistakes all over again and deal with it again. It's just going to happen again, and it's going to repeat itself.
But that's how I learn, you know? Like, right. You make the mistakes so you can learn.
But you make the mistakes over and over and over again.
Listen, original Chris worked in radio for months before this. He knew how to use the software. I had never come into knowing any of the system, how any of this worked, how anyone interacted, when's the time for joking, when's the time for not. I came here to learn because this is the world I want to be in.
But he,
and I was learning. I thought I was.
Okay, he comes from sports radio. So, like, the whole, like, I don't, the time for joking versus the time for not joking, I don't understand what you mean by that.
He thought a lot of times when you're complaining, it was all part of the comedy thing.
Because you've told me that.
You hear what he just said to you, though? He wants to be here. Not for any big game, for his long-term game, to be part of a community. Comedy radio.
Yeah.
I'd like to see the kid do TV, movies, whatever. Anything could happen to him, for all we know. David Tell could come in here and go, hey, there's something about that kid I like. Maybe you should be writing for our show.
I don't think David Tell would like if you came up and tried to book him for one of his side gigs.
Nothing about that bothers me. Nothing about that bothers me. Even if you told him, I don't want you doing that, if he just became friends with these people, maybe it would work out.
But anytime
I've seen it happen a million fucking times, Vito. I see the guys that come in at the young guys, and then within a couple of years, it feels like, hey, everybody's the same. And the next thing you know, you go to the young guy, hey, could you hook up a friend of mine with a gig? Because he's fucking taken off.
I don't know. I can't make a decision. I told you, maybe we could meet, we could talk things out, but as of right
what
now.
What makes it feel like it's your decision to make?
It's not. If you guys want it, it's. I can't say anything. I'm just giving you my input of my personal choice.
You're coming across very negative. Very, very negative. Gail, am I crazy here or what am I missing?
I don't know. I feel like there's got to be more to it because
there has to be.
I've told you guys everything. All of my issues I said with just the work.
Listen, I know I give off like a pretty hateable vibe. You know, like I get it. Like my face, it's like there's like a target on it, and like the voice doesn't help either. I get it. You know, I've read the comments on Twitter. I've heard the callers. This isn't like a warm, welcoming experience to listen to. But I have a very warm heart. I love you, buddy. Even though you hate my guts.
I don't hate you. I just don't like the shit you do. And then I don't like when I tell you did something wrong, you just giggle and you don't take it seriously.
I don't giggle and don't take it seriously. Every time you tell me something's wrong, I'll fix it. I try to. I mean, I'm learning. I do it. I don't just like leave it and then like say what's good. And I only laughed at the card thing because it was funny that I took it and I said I would come back immediately and give it to you immediately after.
It was
and you
LOLs.
Said bring it the morning.
LOLZ. Yeah. It's not that's not it. Funny though because
but
when you funny
me by laugh. Vito, he laughs when he's nervous, much like you.
Who does that remind you of, Vito?
Yeah,
no, that's not laughing
thing.
When
it is. Yes, it is.
It's you laughing when you laughter. Fuck up. I don't laugh when I fuck up.
Yeah, but it causes him to be nervous and uncomfortable, and that makes him laugh.
What did you? You laughed when thing. Someone died.
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
You laughed when I told you I got broken up with.
I did.
Yeah, you did.
You
giggled.
You were like happy about it.
I laugh in tense situations.
You know what? Original Chris, you've been very quiet, but you're on both sides of the glass here. What are we missing? You've picked up on this for a while, right?
Yeah. Yeah, well, I could always tell that there was tension between the two. I'm not going to say who's right or wrong because I don't know who's right or wrong. I just pull my head down and do the job that I'm always asked. Mm. But there has been tension between them since the start. And I would hope that by the end of the show that we can kind of get it all sorted out and they can become friends because I like both of these two. I've
Vito, you
spent a lot of time
an
individually.
I'm a pretty friendly
two.
Person. You know that.
I don't know that. I mean, I saw the way you were today. I would not say that's friendly.
Not at all. I'm not mean to anybody. I'm not malicious.
I just saw you be mean to somebody.
But there's obviously a reason because of what's been happening all semester. And it's just, if I feel this strongly, there's obviously, I'm not just making shit up, you know?
And by the way, you're saying Jam Band is a terrible person. He ended up getting a job here.
Yeah, but he's been kind of a dick ever since he got a job here.
Did you tell him that?
No, I didn't tell him that. I just kind of don't deal with him that much ever since.
even though the best thing for the show is for you to do that.
He's not somebody that is willing to or wants to.
Is that right, Chris?
We've reached out a few times, and he's pushed us off to other people.
I never heard that.
It happened a while ago. Then once that happened, I figured it was no more reason to deal with him.
Why don't we break here? Bennington.
Faction Talk 103, it's the Bennington Show.
People use the amazing Ring video doorbell to help protect their homes. Ring knows home security begins at the front door, but it doesn't end there. So now they're extending that same level of security to the rest of your home with the Ring Floodlight Cam. Just like Ring's amazing doorbell, Floodlight Cam is a motion-activated camera and floodlight that connects right to your phone with HD video and two-way audio that lets you know the moment anyone steps on your property. See and speak to visitors, even set off an alarm right from your phone. With Ring's Floodlight Cam, when things go bump in the night, you'll immediately know what it is. Whether you're home or away, the Ring Floodlight Cam lets you keep an eye on your home from anywhere.
Ring Floodlight offers the ultimate in home security with high visibility floodlights and a powerful HD camera that puts security in your hands. With Ring, you're always home. Save up to $150 off a Ring of Security kit when you go to ring.com/comedy. ring.com/comedy. That's ring.com/comedy.
Faction Talk 103. It's the Bennington Show.
Dish is proud to bring you another hometown concert on December 8th, starting at 8:30 in Eastern Standard Time. Catch one of the hottest live performances of the year. ACM award-winning artist Jake Owen live in concert exclusively with Dish. Catch every second of the live performance on Dish Studio Channel 102 or stream it on Facebook Live at facebook.com/dish.
Hometown is a Dish original concert series celebrating the importance of where we come from and the stories that connect us. Tune in to Dish Studio Channel 102 at 8:30 p.m. in the East for an exclusive interview with Jake Owen, followed by his Jake Owen Foundation benefit concert live from his hometown of Vero Beach, Florida.
Don't miss all the hits from Jake Owen's hometown concert performance. Live December 8th at 8:30 p.m. in the East, only on Dish Studio Channel 102 or streaming on Facebook Live at facebook.com/dish.
Dish is proud to serve hometowns across the country. And thanks to Jake Owen, they're bringing you the best in country music. Learn more at dish.com/hometown or about the foundation at jakeowenfoundation.org. Dish, tuned into you.
It is the Bennington Show. Gail, how's the baby doing?
She is a little uncomfortable, but she's doing better than she was.
Not having the high fever anymore?
No, she doesn't seem very fevery, but she was wailing, poor thing. But now she's a little more chill.
Ugh. Isn't that weird how it brings back a memory when you had the same kind of reaction?
Oh, that's really weird. And you said, like, my face was all red, and her face was so red. Her eyes are all puffy from crying. Yeah. I've never seen her so fucked up.
Yeah, it's so sad. And then what I went through with Vinay had me upset.
I know. I felt the same, exactly. Like, we gave him too many vaccines.
I feel like today was the first time I did not think of Vito as a sweet guy. I saw the Chris Stanley in Vito. I'm not used to that.
Yeah. He's a kind soul, usually.
Chris, you've rubbed off on him.
Yeah. He doesn't teach. He doesn't play well with others. Sad. All I wanted was for us to roll into the end of the year as best as we can. And I literally asked everybody that. And look what we got. Earl, at least I can depend upon you.
I'm always here for you, Ronnie B.
Mr. Bojangles. You know, Earl's dog is up and died. He just up and died. And after 15 years, he still grieves.
Always.
He misses that dog. Send Vito in here as we're wrapping up the show. I think, did the interns walk out?
No, they have not.
They're still sitting there?
Yes.
Did Vito talk to them?
Yes, he had a talking to them.
And what happened?
They're very quiet.
Negative end of the show today. Well, it was supposed to be the intern party.
Yeah. Sometimes the truth just had to happen. It had to happen. Sad it had to be in the intern party, but it had to happen.
And it seems like you're crying.
No, I'm not crying. I'm fine.
It's a Twitter hate show.
I can see that people are not happy with me.
All the feedback is bad.
Pretty negative about me.
Yeah. A lot of people don't want you back in 19.
I hope you choose to keep me.
Might be above me. This makes it upstairs, dude.
Yeah.
It might be well above me. Well, Gail, you said you can see this whole thing coming apart for some time.
I did. I did say that. And now look at us.
And unlike you or Earl, Chris has a place to land at Gaslight Digital. Gaslight Digital, we've got it all.
That's your catchphrase?
You got to be careful with that one guy getting in the strange powders.
I have but one master. You, Ron Bennington.
That's how you're on. You're not even paying attention, but that wasn't the setup?
I just thought I'd let everyone know.
Oh. Everyone's being so tight. That's the kind of answers I'm getting here today. Well, Gail, you've got one sick little baby, but I got three sick little babies over here.
I know. That makes me sad, too.
Yeah.
I hope that you care for them. Hold them, give them
I never saw the interns head out in a bad mood before.
I did what I had to do. I had to fucking tell the kid that he wasn't doing the right thing for 3 months. It's not great, but none of us were getting what we needed. There were a ton of mistakes that piled up.
I was getting everything I could possibly want out of an intern. I hadn't seen anybody this good since Earl Douglas. Young Earl Douglas. I've never seen anybody but Earl do this. He can pitch just as well with either hand.
Really? Switch pitcher.
Yeah. Switch pitcher. So you don't know whether you're getting the fucking slider inside or the fucking fastball outside. You can get either one. You're never going to see a curve, though. No one sees a curve. Because he hangs a fucking curve like a pinata out there. Miss being able to play the old game, Earl?
Oh, yeah.
Miss that? You lost your skills?
Oh, I miss it every single day. Love playing the game. Love watching it, but love playing it. It's a joy to it.
Your mantra is always the same. Don't hit it to me. Don't hit it to me. They always say it's the worst thing that you could say in baseball is don't hit it to me. It's like the ball knows to go to that guy. Well, I guess you woofed today, huh? You went 0 for 4 today, Vito.
Yeah. Got into a fight with the umpire, I guess.
Who's the umpire?
I don't know. I guess I'm saying Vinay's the umpire, but that doesn't make much sense.
Mm-mm. Think of it this way.
That's for sure.
You wanted to go out of your way to make sure Nuke wasn't going to get to the pros.
I'm not a Bull Durham. I forgot his name.
That's good radio.
I forgot his character's name.
But how could you forget that?
Crash Davis.
Mm-hmm.
Look, I just told you guys the truth. I just did what I had to tell you guys what was really going on back here. I didn't want you guys to be misled.
You're just digging it deeper for yourself.
I am.
Even when I see that the kid was teared up a little bit. I feel like something else must have happened. Some kind of either sexual assault or something along those lines.
Please don't put that out there. There was no sexual stuff.
But it seemed like somebody. No. I mean, somebody isn't going to cry because they're not won it back. So he definitely seemed like he was sexually assaulted.
I didn't sexually assault anybody.
But if you did, we'll get to the bottom of it. Lotus, the Bush funeral going down. I didn't know this, but Laura Bush has somewhat of a duck walk. I don't know why I never picked up on that before. I had web feet. And Jeb Bush has got a tiny little cute wife. Look how tiny she is. Comes up to his armpit.
He's a bigger guy than I realized.
Oh, yeah. He's a big guy. He's the Gronk of the Bush family. When they play fucking pickup ball, they always send him deep and down the middle. And they say, if you just throw it anywhere, he'll come up with it. Look at the size of him. I saw him once palm a beer keg. Just picked it straight up off. Yeah. And look how tiny his wife is. She looks like a jockey. Bush has got a big family. Well, Gail, we're going to wrap this one up. Do me a favor and take care of that baby, would you?
I definitely will.
By that baby, I meant Vinay.
I'm going to.
Vinay and Original Chris, thank you guys so much.
Thank you, guys.
Are they coming over
to
the mic?
Thank you.
Thank you, buddy.
Come on over.
Say thank you.
Thank you for
thank
a great
Ron,
semester.
Thank Chris,
you guys,
Vito, Earl.
Yeah, you guys are great.
Appreciate it. Good fun.
Yeah. All right, that's it for us. Anything we need to plug, Christopher?
The brand new Bennington shirt that's available now at ibangshop.com, ibangshop.com, and go to charitybuzz.com to be on a chance to co-host the Bennington show ends December 12th.
All right.